I'm Ray.
And I'm Veronica.
And welcome to the Chick Lit Book Club podcast,
where we read a romance novel and then we talk about it. Today, we're talking about Consider Me by Becka Mack.
Yay, I was trying to do my Yay. Oprah for you. Do you enjoy that?
Yes. I love you so much.
Oh, Oprah. I love you too, Vanessa Carlton. And
thank you
I love
so much.
Oprah. Raymond Burr. You can call me Raymond Burr.
One of my new coworkers, I adore her so much. And she always says, thank you so much. And like, that's every single time I say thank you now, I just think of her like, thank you so much. Because it's just very like, the way she says it, it's just so sweet and sincere.
It's just it's not like, you know, how I would say like, oh, thank you so much.
Oh, thank you so much. No, there's nothing
sarcastic
about it.
It's not a
bless your heart. Like, it's very much like she's like, thank you so much. Just the way she said it, I'll never be able to do it. But it's just like, thank you so much. It's just, it's very sincere.
She's young. She's really young, isn't she?
Mid to late 20s.
Okay.
She's very sweet. I adore her so much. And also, she started listening to the podcast.
Oh! It just seems like a very young, you know, like, because me, I'm also jaded and angry and old. So there you go. Like, I'm like, here's me. It's fine. Just fucking, it's fine. It's fine. It's fine. Whatever. It's fine. That's where I'm at.
She's also the one who is like, when are you getting a tattoo? She's very enabling.
Oh, she's the one? Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We're doing it, okay?
Tomorrow,
calm
we're
down.
Doing it.
Calm your tits. Oh, good times. Mm-hmm. Hey!
What's up?
Tell me something good. should we tell them what we're going to try to do first in this episode?
Yeah,
we're
going
to try to
we
do
should.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you want me to go? Why don't you go? Why don't you give the rules.
All right, so here's the rules for the game we're going to play tonight. And we don't know that we're going to be able to do this in real time. We may have to listen to the episode later and do a real tally. Yeah. All right, so in this book that we are discussing tonight... you got yourself... Ray just spit...
I'm fine. It's fine.
You're
it's
fine.
Fine. Mm-hmm.
Fine. All right.
I made it come out my nose.
There you go. There you go. All right. So tonight in Consider Me by Becka Mack, there is a swear jar.
Mm-hmm.
And every single time anyone swears around like the 8-year old, however old, 7, 8, 9 year old she is.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. She gets a dollar, or like it's a swear jar, but she gets to keep them
for mom's fancy wines and, and shoes.
And then at the end, she's allowed to keep the money. And so, like, I don't remember why or like when. Maybe it's when the hockey playoffs are happening. She's allowed to keep the money and buy whatever she wants. But yeah, before that, it's for mom's fancy wines.
Fancy wines and shoes. Love it.
So anyway, we're gonna try to keep a tally. Yeah. Of how many times we have to do it independently. You do yours, I'll do mine.
Oh, Jesus. Okay. Oh,
count?
Damn it. Damn. Okay. I had to get a notebook out. Hold on. Oh, it's my Bridgerton notebook. Let me get to the hate. Oh, there we are. Okay.
hate. If I say the quotes that we will owe more to the swear jar.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay, Wynn. It's just me. It's okay. She's like,
yeah, I would just like to, you know, real quick. I mean, fucking Bridgerton just blew up this week, didn't it? Damn it!
yes. Okay, so that's our game. Yes. My bright spot... You just nailed it. My bright spot is the way that our Viscount Who Loved Me episode has blown the fuck up swear jar. Like, it is unreal. We have never had an episode do so well so quickly.
Yeah.
It's incredible. Like, we just keep every single time the page refreshes, we're like, what is happening?
And we text each other and we're like, oh my God!
Just
like,
insanity. So thank you if you are new here, because apparently we have quite a few new people around these days. Thank you so much for being here.
What's your other thing that you usually say? If you're new here.
Oh, if you're new here. Welcome. There you go. We are super excited that you're here. Please stay and hang out with us. We're nerdy book ladies who drink wine and cuss a lot. So, yeah. As evidenced by whatever amount we are apparently going to donate to charity later tonight.
We have to decide what charity it is.
We haven't decided what charity yet.
Possibly kids playing hockey. Yeah.
Maybe the children's literacy. Yeah. Who knows?
Who knows? We'll figure
something out.
At a later date.
Yes. once we save up for how much it's going to cost us to do this. I'm not sorry. So anyway, my bright spot has been watching the Viscount Who Loved Me episode just take off.
Nice.
Into the stratosphere.
Into the strat.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Nice.
Ray?
Yeah?
Tell me something good.
I just realized, like, before we started, I was like, God, I don't think I have anything that happened. Because we also haven't talked. It's not been very long since we were, like, seeing each other.
Yeah, I saw you on Monday.
Yeah, so. Oh, let me see. I'm gonna go.
Can I give you one?
Yeah.
We got approved for Alexis Hall ARCs.
Oh, yeah. Yay. Yes, absolutely. I'm excited for that. The Lady for a Duke.
Lady for a Duke, I believe.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, I had pre-ordered that. Like, it's supposed to come, and it's going to have something fancy with it, like some sort of thing that Alexis is supposed to have signed or something. I don't know. I'm fine. It's cool. I'm excited. But I was like, why don't we do it for the show, and then we can see if we can get an arc. Because then we can get it earlier, and we can then actually do it for the show. So...
I'm very excited. That'll be the end of May we do that.
Yeah, so we're going to do like a gear up to...
It's a Pride Month.
Pride Month, so we're going to start Pride Month a little early.
Hell yeah.
Why the fuck not?
I said hell. Does that count?
No.
Okay.
No, that one's in the Bible, I think. I only had, you know, let's see, about 12 years of Catholic school.
I can beat you by one. 13.
Ooh, that's like probably not a good number.
Who the fuck cares? Oops.
As I said in our Bridgerton page of screen,
I don't go to church anymore, you guys.
I'm sure 13 you wasn't tell. A lucky number for us. Ooh. So we're excited about that.
You know what? I do want to say, I'll make a TikTok about it later, but Nisha, what is her? Hang on. Someone made... a very excellent point.
Oh, you're telling me about it, yeah.
Yeah, so there is... Yes, Nisha Sharma, is that her name? She wrote Dating Dr. Dill.
Yeah,
which I did buy recently because people were giving her shit about it. People were giving her stuff about it. Yeah, I mean, of course, but it's ridiculous.
People are the worst.
And who cares? Because people are the worst. Okay, so
beautiful. I see you.
Yes. Nisha Sharma, she, if I'm remembering her TikTok correctly, she is South Indian and has purposefully not been making comments about, like, too much about Bridgerton because she is not North Indian, which I guess is where that Sharma family is from. Mm-hmm. She was saying, like, I need people to stop talking about the show not following the book closely enough because, and this is something that as a white person, I did not consider, obviously, that the in the 21st century, like the look of an Indian person being forced into marriage with an English person does not look good. Because of the colonization that has happened there
by
English people.
Right.
So, like, that's not something that I thought about. That was not a thing that bothered me with the show. Like, the fact that the bee sting did not force the marriage did not bother me. Because it actually did bother me in the book. That they were, like, it was the second Bridgerton who was forced into marriage. Like, I just...
Well, and that's, if you read any historical romance, there's going to be some point where they're going to be compromised, where there's just they're in a room together by themselves.
Right.
So, I mean, that's just unfortunately. Stop. That's how it was. Sorry.
Right.
Bookie S. Barnes is being bad.
But so cute.
No, it's not, because he's chewing on me right now.
Okay, well, that's not good.
Go lay down.
So, at any rate.
So, I get it. I don't agree necessarily. I agree with which her point, but mm-hmm. I think for a lot of people who have read the book, I think they're upset. Not the bee sting aside, I think bee sting is like the least bit of what I'm upset about.
That was
about.
The least of what I was upset about. I mean, right. At least we got the bee sting scene.
Right. Right.
And it was a very intense moment between the two of them.
I'm okay if in that moment, like, it's funny in the book because he's literally got his mouth on her boob almost. But
yeah, like on her exposed flesh.
I mean, can we talk about like well, we already did, but like what upset me more is we don't get the Newton like falling in the water, that sort of thing. Like that's yeah. what I'm mad about. I mean,
I'm mad that we didn't get the thunderstorm scene.
Right. I mean, I don't think anything of like. Unfortunately, like I don't know. I totally get what she's coming from, and I totally get that too. But I think that for the majority of people who have read the book and they're upset, it's because it is so different.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
not necessarily that scene. So if they're upset primarily just because of the bee scene, then okay, then you need to reevaluate. But there's like a lot other issues going on there.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I mean, you and I are the biggest like Simone Ashley like fucking proponent.
Yeah, like stands for Simone Ashley.
Yeah,
oh, there you go again.
I wrote it.
There you go. I didn't even notice you did it until you were leaning over to make your little tally mark.
Yeah.
So it's like desensitized I am to it.
And I mean, I think we even said on the episode. I know I did. I said if you don't care, if you care that they are, from India and they're East Indian, you can go mm-hmm. and that's upsetting to you, and you're right. upset because they changed them from Sheffield to Sharma. You can go mm-hmm. fuck yourself, and I right. will take that one. That's fine.
Yep.
Because I'm still telling you people, go fuck yourself. You're a racist asshole. Oh god damn.
There you go. Good thing it's not a drinking game, huh?
Oh, I'd be under the table.
We would be dead.
Speaking of under the table, I got a deck of cards here.
Mm.
Possibly one of the cards might feature someone having sex under a table. Tables are highly, you know, they're involved in these cards a lot. If they're not, we draw them on. So
that's true. We do draw a lot of surfaces.
Because, you know, you need a lot of core strength. I don't know if everyone's got that much core strength to do a lot of these things.
Here's probably not most Americans. I'm going to take a guess on that.
No. Oh, jeez.
Again, shout out to Janky, by the way. I owe you an email.
Okay, this one is sad. Because
oh no,
it's these cannot be the okay. Fine, it's 3 out of 5. It's called Ease In Backwards. It's literally just reverse cowgirl. Couples, wait, hold on, make my whistle down on. Couples can enjoy varying the angle of penetration with this position. He should lie comfortably on his back while she eases in backwards. He can experiment by using pillows for elbow support to arch his back. She can experiment with varying the angle of her back. It's just reverse cowgirl.
Just reverse cowgirl, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Do you have any reverse cowgirl books? I don't believe I do.
You know what's interesting? I really feel like I read one lately that did, but now I can't remember which one it was.
It's funny. We talked about after... after the card, we did find ones that you found one in the book you were reading for the one we had last time. Because
yes.
you sent me, yeah. And mm-hmm. I did too. It was really funny because there was a historical romance that I read that was like one leg up sort of thing.
Yeah, so, right. Mm-hmm.
What we should do, because this isn't creepy at all, is we should just like have a Google Doc. And of like, here's the book, and here's the sex positions they were in.
Just include it in the show notes.
We're excited.
Oh, Jesus.
Oh, we'll be the Mr. Skin of romance novels. Mr. Mortimer J. Skin. You know who Mr. Skin is, right?
I don't.
Mr. Skin, I don't know if it's still even a website. It used to be a website of just like nudity in movies. Like,
oh.
you could go see, like, this actress was nude in these movies, and here are the scenes.
Oh.
Yeah. Let's, okay. You know what? Let's look and see. Okay, not work email or not work account. Okay.
Not work account.
Not work account. Mr. Skin. Oh, yes, it's still thriving. It's still up and thriving. Oh, am I 18 years older? Yes, I am. Oh, okay. Promo of the year. The sexiest film and boob tube nudes of 2021. You know I want to click it. You know I want to click it.
I know you want to click it. Don't click it.
I'm going to click. I just clicked
it. Oh, God. Okay. It's like that TikTok sound. I'm not going to do it, girl. I'm just thinking about it. I'm not going to do it. I did it.
Okay. All right. So they've got it broken down. Like, they're like Emmy, like Academy Awards. So the best breasts are Sydney Sweeney from The Voyeurs. I've never seen that. Oh, she does have a nice butt. Best butt was Sarah Shahi in Sex Life. She's got a Jonathan Bailey butt. I have no idea what these shows are. Best lesbian scene is Catherine Waterston. Oh, isn't Catherine Waterston, isn't that Sam Waterston's daughter?
Maybe.
And Vanessa Kirby in The World to Come. I literally have no idea what any of these things are. Like, there's these, I haven't seen one that I know. Oh, Benedetta. Okay. Yeah, I know that one. Wow. Okay. There's a lot of, oh, here's a good one. Best side bush. So that's side bush.
Wow.
Leah Seydoux, The French Dispatch. Wasn't that a Wes Anderson movie?
I have no idea.
That's weird. Okay. So yeah, the Mr. Skin, guys. Mr. Skin.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Shall we take a brief respite?
Yeah.
And we shall return.
Yeah. Yeah.
The look on your face did not look pleasant.
Mm-mm. I'm still going through this list.
Oh, God.
We will be back after a little breaky from us in... Watch Knowledge Fight, guys. In 2 and 2.
And we're back.
We're back, bitches. Damn it. Damn it. I knew in my head. I was like, I'm going to say it, and then I'm going to have to mark it down.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And in true Carter style, you then cussed a bunch because you realized you swore.
Yep. Little kids playing hockey. It's fine.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Maybe like the Boys and Girls Club or something.
Yeah. Yeah. We know people who used to work there, so yeah.
We do.
Mm-hmm. I work with one of them now.
Yes, you do. That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I know people that still do through my other volunteer work.
Coolio.
Yeah. Anywho, we should get to discussing this book, shall we?
Do that. Yes.
All right. So if you have been listening to the podcast for a while, again, welcome. but we actually, Ray read Becca Mack's first book, which was Love You Wild. Mm-hmm. And that was like a while back. And you read it and reviewed it. Mm-hmm. And I think you recommended it on the podcast, but mm-hmm. we did not like read it for the podcast.
We did not, no.
Okay. So at any rate, we found out that she was coming out with another book. We wanted to have her on the show, but it just wasn't working out like schedule-wise toward the end of last year. And we wanted to give her time to like, you know, hang out with her baby and stuff.
Yeah, her adorable baby.
Seriously adorable. So anywho, here we are in April now. Mm-hmm. And her book came out on March 22nd. Yep. And so we were like, hey.
Hi. We're Bridgerton land right now, but as soon as we get back to this time period.
As soon as we're back into like present day, can we read your book? Maybe you want to be on our show? Yeah.
We'll get in our TARDIS and come back to this time and mm-hmm. come see us.
Yeah, and gracious Becca was like, yes, I would love to do that. So we read her book this week, and we, at the time we are recording this, we have not spoken to her yet. We're doing our interview tomorrow night because of schedules. Mm-hmm. So, at any rate, this is her second book that I know of, right? Mm-hmm. So without further ado, here is the blurb for Consider Me. Carter Beckett is the NHL's resident bad boy, top player both on the ice and in the bedroom, and quite possibly the sexiest man to ever grace my field of vision. But worst of all, he knows it. He's arrogant, self-centered, and the man doesn't seem to know what a filter is, let alone how to use one. He's had everything served to him on a silver platter, including endless strings of women, and apparently, I'm up next. His only problem? I have no intention of falling for his charm. I have the solution to all of my sexual frustrations in a drawer at home, and it's far less complicated than Carter Beckett. Sure, he may be pretty, but he's also a walking, talking reminder for you to wrap it up before you tap it. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry. Wrap it before you tap it. But then I start letting my guard down, and he starts showing me pieces of himself I had no intention of seeing. The bricks surrounding me may be tumbling down one by one, but I'm not sold yet, which means for the first time in his life, Carter's the one begging. For my time, my trust, for a single chance, for me to just consider him.
All right, so I'm trying to think of what else we need to... Because we don't give it away too much, this is, you know, fairly new, but there's not much to give away, really.
No, there's not a lot to give away.
We're not going to give the big conflict away, not... but...
No, no. The conflict is set up pretty well there.
It is,
The one thing I will say that the blurb does not give away is that this is dual perspective.
Yes, and I loved it. Loved it.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Very much.
Yeah.
Actually, I knew when I opened the book.
Oh, yeah. You texted me.
I texted you immediately, and I said, okay, points for Becca already. Number one, this is dual perspective. Number two, the first word is fuck.
Yep.
Excuse me while I make a tally.
Yep. And he's naked and taking off a condom.
He is naked. Yep.
So
literally finishing up with a girl he is about to kick out of his hotel room.
Yeah, and so it remind me, in the blurb, did it say that Olivia is... Okay, so it's like the best friend...
Actually, it didn't even say her name in the blurb.
Oh.
Her name is Olivia.
Olivia. And so Olivia Parker, who she is a high school phys ed teacher. And this takes place in Canada. And
Vancouver.
And so she is... best friends with Kara, who's dating Emmett, who's best friends with Carter. And Emmett's also on the hockey team, the Vipers hockey team.
Yeah, so, Vancouver Vipers.
Mm-hmm. And so you have, like, extraneous players that are friends also that are in the story. And then, she puts him down, like, pretty hard. Because she's, like, heard...
Oh, my God.
She's heard the horror. I mean, he's, like, he's a celebrity. So it's, like, it's a flavor of the day. It's not even flavor of the week. It's flavor of the night with him. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And, like, he's pretty, like... I mean, not upset, like, not shy about, like, yeah, this is my...
No.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, he's not at all.
Mm-mm, no. And...
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he sees her. So she and Kara have been friends since college. Mm-hmm. So, like, so for... I think they met when they were freshmen. Mm-hmm. So they've been friends for, like, a good 7 years. And Kara has known Carter for a good year.
Yeah, yeah.
But has never introduced him to Olivia.
Yeah, and Olivia's
specifically
been like,
because he's a man whore.
Right, and she's... There is a fight happening on my stairs right now.
I can hear it. Jerks.
I'm waiting to see if one is on the other side of the fence, and it's like prison. So one's downstairs, and one's like...
They're having a fight from across the yard.
Yeah, I guess, yeah. One brings their milkshake to the yard, and the other one...
Mm.
Uh-huh. I might have to pause and go and shut the door. I'm going to do that because she's obnoxious. Poor Luna.
I'm just gonna let you know I now have that song in my head.
All the milkshakes bringing the boys to the yard.
Yep. Yeah. Thank you for that.
Hey, no problem. I'm trying to think. And so, yeah.
So what happens is that, like, I guess it's... I mean, this happens very early in the book. It's like after a win or something, or like all of them are going out one night.
It's Kara's birthday.
Oh, it's Kara's birthday. That's right. So. They all go out, and, like, the moment he sees her, he's like, I want that one.
Yeah. At first, it is like, well, he does say something about his breath getting taken away from him. But at first it is, I just want to fuck her.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's all he knows. I mean, that's all he knows. It's all he does.
Right.
You know?
Right. And we learn why later.
Yeah.
But yeah. And yeah, it's immediate. And she's like, no, you got a dirty dick. Get out of here.
Yeah. She literally accuses him of like having venereal disease.
She does. A number of times having STDs.
Yep. Yep. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And in fact, like he comes over and hits on her. And she just stares at this Sarah McLachlan ASPCA commercial. Yes. So she doesn't have to talk to him.
Yep.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Kudos to her because I couldn't make it through it. Well,
she's pretty feisty. And
she
love that about her.
I am here for it. Here for mm-hmm. it. Mm-hmm. Do we want to do our compliment sandwich then?
Yes, shall we?
Yeah. So if you are, again, new to the podcast...
Welcome.
Thank you. We do a compliment sandwich here. So the first, we call it the top bun, is our first pro, where something that we liked about the book. Our meat is our con, so something we might not have liked as much. And then our bottom bun is another pro, so we end on a high note, is it, the bottom bun. So that's how we mm-hmm, hit it. Mm-hmm. Hit me with your pro, baby!
We do not hit it and quit it.
We don't. We don't.
No.
Neither does Carter, supposedly, now.
Apparently.
Yeah.
Supposedly. Okay, so my top bun.
Yep.
Is a trope that I fucking love. And you know it. You had to have known I was going to say it. Yep. This is the second book in a row we have done. Mm-hmm. You know I love a reformed rake. Come at me with a playboy who has met the one woman who is, like, making him not want to be a man whore anymore.
Yeah.
And I'm already all in.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. Already 110% diving into that book.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I don't know what that says about my mental health. Probably nothing good.
I think I'm 100% on... Well, that's all I read are historical romances. So, of course, that's right. All
lots
it is.
Lots of enemies to lovers.
Enemies to lovers with a lot of it's... Not all of it, but a lot of it is enemies to lovers. But most of it is reform rakes. Like...
Yeah.
Small percentage of them are not like are people who have not gotten dipped their wick in literally every pot in town. Yep. Inkwell mm-hmm. in town. Yep.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And Carter is very much, I mean, we literally, the book opens with him like
kicking a girl out.
Feelingly, very ruthlessly kicking a girl out of his hotel room.
Yep. Yep.
Like, just no qualms whatsoever.
No.
Just wants her gone. He says, I don't do sleepovers.
Yep.
And she's like, can I give you my number? And he's like, I think he says, like, fine, you can give me your number. But like,
he like pretty much throws it away.
Yeah, he basically just throws it away immediately because he doesn't want it. I mean, he has no intention of ever seeing her again.
Says,
he literally doesn't remember her name.
No.
He calls her by the wrong name.
Because it's Laura and he keeps calling her Lacey or something.
Lacey or something, yeah.
Well, and also he takes her, like, she's in the room with his phone. I think this is the part where she's in the room with his phone and he takes his phone because she doesn't want him, want her access anywhere close to his phone to be able to put her number in it or get his number. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's the only girl we see him with, like, for real.
Right. Right.
Yeah. So other than Olivia, obviously.
Right.
But you know me, you know I love me a reformed rake.
Oh, like, yeah.
And Carter is very quintessential in that trope. Just.
Yeah, I mean.
Like endless string of women.
Right.
And at one point, she obviously knows this about him. And it is an insecurity for her.
Right.
A lot.
As
in
would
large part,
most of us.
Of course.
Yeah.
And in large part because, like, the things that the media starts writing about her are not favorable.
No.
The first thing that they write about her when they figure out who she is, like, will she be enough for Carter? Will she be enough to make Carter, like, calm
monogamous.
Down?
Monogamous, yeah.
And monogamous.
Yeah.
And that's a sore spot for her.
Mm-hmm.
And at one point, like, she figures out that... So he has a condo in town, like in downtown Vancouver, but he has a big ass house. Darn it. He has a huge house, like on the outskirts of the city and like overlooking the mountains, and it's beautiful and peaceful and quiet.
Seven fireplaces.
7 fireplaces. There are many discussions about the number of fireplaces. But he never brings women there. He only brings women back to his condo. Mm-hmm. And one time, like, their night has taken, like, a turn. And not because of anything that either of the two of them have done. It's just, like, circumstances around them, people around them. And he just wants to get out of the bar. And he takes her to the condo, which she has never been to before. And she just has, like, a panic attack. Yeah. And it's just, like, don't touch me. Get away from me. And, like, it's her from her perspective at that point. And it is, like, she's walking around and, like, finding drawers full of condoms.
And phone numbers, yeah.
Phone numbers, mm-hmm, with, like, lipstick kisses on them, mm-hmm, and stuff. And she's just like, I don't want to be here. Like, you've got to get me out of here.
Yeah. And he doesn't recognize that in that moment. Like, he just wants to be with her. Like, he just, like, mm-hmm, he wants to have sex with her, obviously. But he wants to be, mm-hmm, with her at that moment. And he could not wait, which I was like, and part of that's immaturity, too. So, like, yeah.
Yeah. You know.
Yeah.
Right. But yeah, anywho, what is your top bun?
Well, let's not move away from Carter then. Let's just stay with him.
Fine.
I mean, I really like Carter in general. But what I really like about him is that he has a lot of emotional intelligence, but I don't think he's ever really used it because he's never had to use it. But there are a couple instances where he is more in tune with what's happening in their relationship than she is. Like, he can see what's happening, mm-hmm, and he calls her out on it, and in a very, very emotionally intelligent way, like a very, like, highly intelligent way, where you're, mm-hmm, like, wow, nobody who's and, like, he keeps joking about how he's killing it as a boyfriend. This is his first girlfriend. He's never had a girlfriend.
Right, he's never had a relationship before.
And he really is. And he's really killing it. And so I would like, mm-hmm, to read the one in particular. Like, they have a couple arguments. Like, this is, like, their first argument. And I really enjoyed how I'm in the wrong book. How he handled it and how he responded to her. Because she's pretty much, like, turned him down and pretty much shut him down a couple times where he's really tried and she's like, this isn't gonna work, and leaves.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm, because she's scared. So they're, mm-hmm, actually really into it. Like, they're, like, in a relationship, and she starts to do it. And he, mm-hmm, and she says, that's not the right one. That's another one with Hank. Hank.
Love Hank. God, Hank.
Oh, there we go. Okay. You know what happened if I took you home right now? Because this is where she's fighting. Like, they're leaving somewhere, and she's thinking that he's just gonna drop her off at home, and she's gonna go home, and they're gonna be done. This is gonna be the end of the relationship. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't. They start going to his home, and mm-hmm, he says, "You know what would happen if I took you home right now?" This is from Olivia's perspective. My lips part to give him an answer, although I don't really have one. He cuts me off anyway. First of all, it would be the last thing I want to do and the last thing you'd want to. Let's be honest. I leave you beyond angry with myself, and you pretend you were done with me. That it was for the best. Then you get inside, put on your pajamas, have 5 minutes to cool down, and realize you're angry with yourself too. You'd cry over our fight like you're doing right now because you'd feel bad that you hurt me with your words. And me? He gestures at himself as he looks me over, watching my tears continue to fall. I'll get home, be pissed at myself for letting you walk away, leaving you when you're upset and vulnerable, that you're once again dealing with the consequences of my reckless past choices. And I'd get in my car and drive all the way back to you. Mm-hmm. I mean, like, it's really pretty, you know, like, empathetic for somebody who has a shitty past like he does, like, who has trust issue. I mean, actually, he doesn't, mm-hmm, the one who has, she's the one who has trust issues, rightly so.
Well, yeah, mm-hmm,
but he's actually doesn't have trust issues. Like, he, it's funny, like, he doesn't for once question that she's, like, in this as, like, a gold digger trying to get close to him.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Like, there's just no, in fact, like, he buys her things and she gets upset about it.
Yeah.
He
buys her, like, one, I don't want to give it away, but he buys her, like, one particularly expensive gift.
Mm-hmm.
And she cries.
Yep.
And tells him that she will set up a payment plan to pay him back.
Yeah. Let's see. Carter's eyes fall shut with a deep inhale before, I guess I never wanted to be able to have effect on a person or vice versa. It's scary to think that losing somebody could absolutely crush your soul like that. Because he's talking about his dad.
Yeah.
And he says, absolutely crush your soul like that. And you'll spend the rest of your days, this killed me, living out your life, waiting for that moment you can be together again. Because he's talking about his dad's dad. So he's saying his mom is just waiting for the moment she can die and then be back with her father. I mean, that's, you have to imagine, yeah. I mean, that's pretty like in tune with your emotions for somebody who's very much cut off from them. I'm looking to see if I had any other ones. I want to read this. I don't want to give it too much away. I want to read part of it. This is where he's describing her to Hank.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, this is, yeah, I don't want to say why he's describing her. I squeeze my eyes shut for the briefest moment because I don't want to miss a second of this. I can't. I'm sorry. There's no words. She's like waking up on Christmas morning when you're 3 years old and you finally understand what it's all about. She's the moment the rain stops and the sun comes out, lighting up the sky with color, and everything smells new and fresh. She's the first skate on a frozen lake, surrounded by snowy mountains and pine trees and the freshest breath of air. She's rolling over in the middle of the night, pulling that warm body into yours and curling around it, and everything's just right. She's just perfection. Hank finishes quietly. Carter fucking wins it, man. I'm saying, like, he does. He says, I fucking rule at this, like, you know, boyfriend thing. And he does. He does. Mm-hmm. He does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He does. There are a lot of jokes about how he's good at everything he does.
Yeah, there's a lot of jokes. He's a smug bastard.
He is a smug, arrogant bastard. Yeah. But he is also confident.
He's a good dude. He really is a good dude.
Yes. Yeah. But also is a hard worker and will do whatever he puts his mind to.
Yeah.
So, like, the fact that he decides that he is going to be a great boyfriend for Olivia, he is in it. He is in it 1,000%.
Jump Street.
From Jump Street.
Yep.
He's in it.
He's in it.
He's just completely in it. Hang on, let me. There are a couple. He has a really filthy mouth, really filthy all the time. Very dirty mind.
Guess who's
very funny?
Guess who's doing the swear jar on this one? This quote. Yep, come on, rate it.
Oh, there are so many. Like, I haven't even picked one in particular. There is one thing that they both say separately at one point that made me laugh really hard. It's New Year's Eve, and she says, in her mind, her internal monologue, she says, I love a foot rub and to be politely railed into the new year, if I'm being honest. And then I have to find it. He says something very similar about her. He says, I genuinely care about her and I want to spend time with her, but I would also throw myself at her feet if it meant she'd let me destroy her body because I want to absolutely wreck her. And I mean that in the most respectful way possible. Of course.
There's a lot about wrecking her pussy.
Yeah. Although she says, why isn't his stormtrooper invading my territory right now? He's also a goofball.
Oh, like, yeah.
A real goofball.
I love my girlfriend.
And attention whore. Yes. There's one point when she's like before they get together and she is still like not. She's really trying to like resist him, but she clearly has feelings for him and he clearly has feelings for her. Kara kind of like sets her up and she ends up back at Kara and Emmett's place and Carter is there. And of course, Kara knows that.
Yeah.
Olivia is like freaked out by that, does not realize it, but she walks into the kitchen and he's like standing there and he goes,
oh, I love this part.
Hi, Olivia. He's yelling. I don't know if he realizes. Good. He sputters. You look good. Still yelling. He slams the fridge door and drops his elbow to the countertop, nearly missing his chin when he tries to prop it up in his palm.
Also, he's 6'4", so you can imagine this is even funnier.
Yep, like very, he's very coordinated, like physically, because he's an athlete.
Right.
but then like he's super clumsy in this moment when he's trying to talk to her. There's another who says, hang on, who says this? Yeah, this is also Carter. He says, when you love someone so wholly, it makes you weak. You risk pieces of yourself that you can't afford to lose.
Mm-hmm. I will give it to Becca because she has written this character where at no point did I think that he was either like, this was not genuine.
Yeah, that's true.
And she did a really good job of writing somebody who's like, it hit him and it hit him hard. And he was like, mm-hmm. this is it for me. Like, I did really feel that for him. Like, for her, it was a little harder, obviously. But, like, she mm-hmm. did feel the connection. But, of course, she was a little bit more, you know, reserved. Because, you know, he's Carter Beckett.
Yep. A string of women who all look very, I mean, they look like supermodels.
Right.
And she is a 5'1".
Gym teacher. Like,
he calls her Pipsqueak.
Yeah.
Like, she's very small.
Yeah. Nothing against gym teachers. I'm just saying, it's just, you know, like, she's a teacher. She's not, like, a supermodel. Like, some of these women are literally, like, we open on this Lacey or Lauren or whatever, saying she was on the Maxim for, like, she says it, like, 13 times.
She's 13 times. She literally says, and he's like, yes, I noticed. I counted. I started counting after the third time or something.
Yeah. So, no, I wasn't hating. I'm like, no, I work with teachers. I work in the school. So, no, I'm not hating on teachers. Just...
Oh, yeah, no. They live in different worlds. Here's another one about how effing amazing Carter is. I'm about to swear. Yeah. So, like, he says, I can't change my past, but if you give me the chance, I can change my future. But I need all of you, Ollie, not half of you. I watch the scrape of my thumb along her lower lip. I know I flip your world upside down. You fucking demolish mine. Please, let me in. Let me see you. Let me have you. All of you. Mm-hmm. One for the swear jar.
It's okay.
I know. That one was totally worth it.
I also love that he calls her Ollie, because everyone calls her Ollie. I also love the name Olivia. I love the name Olive. I love...
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But literally everyone calls her Ollie.
Yeah. I was trying to find... My dog is currently playing with her bell. Can you hear that?
Mm-hmm.
She's an asshole. Oh. Okay, so he... hang on. He meets his sister's dance partner.
Oh, Simon? Simon, yeah.
Is it Simon?
I think it's Simon.
Simon is trying to get with Jenny.
Yes.
Clearly.
Yeah.
And Simon, it's funny because Simon is very much the way Carter used to be.
Uh-huh.
And so he's hugging his sister. She pretends to hug me. You just hate him. You're damn right I do. I accidentally say too loud. I twist back to Simon. Who you hooking up with tonight, Steve? Olivia thinks I'm sweet, but I'm kind of a dick sometimes. If I don't know you, and I don't like Simon, which is why I sometimes, occasionally, call him by the wrong name. He fucks every girl he dances with, and he has his sights set on my sister for 4 years. I could ask you the same thing, he replies with a smile. So self-assured, I want to punch it off his face.
You know what that reminds me of? It reminds me of the hating game where Lucy's parents call...
They call him by the wrong name.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, Josh, like Jock and
Jeremiah and like
Jared
Jack.
And yeah.
I forget which name it was, but at one point she goes, he called you by like the wrong name once and I laughed so hard I cried. I don't remember what it was though. He also says at one point, I would chop the dick off of any man with a history like mine who tried to get near my daughter. And then I'd lock her up until she was 30, maybe even 35. All girls school would probably be a good option. Unless she likes girls.
Yes!
Fuck, nowhere is safe. And I believe that is at least one more. Okay. I was trying to find like one where he says like dirty stuff, like because he's ridiculous. Oh, at one point, This is like much later on. Olivia's lips purse, thumb skimming her chin like she needs to think long and hard about it. Ha, long and hard. That's what she... No, Carter, be more mature.
You know what I like?
He calls his dick Mr. Incredible.
He calls it a lot of things.
He calls it a lot of things.
The one I love is where... So her brother is like set against her dating. Set against her dating. This is Jeremy. This is Olivia's brother. And and then she goes over to like one night to kind of like smooth things over. And her niece, Alana, is like very excited because she also plays hockey. So she's very excited. So, and as she's leaving, Jeremy goes, gives her a jersey for her to sign. He's like, can you have him sign it? So she's spending time with Alana and, after this, and she said, please do try to contain your enthusiasm, Jeremy. Twisting back from Alana, I pull a gift from my bag and grin. This is for you from Carter. She unravels the small jersey, jaw hanging while she examines it. To Alana, hustle hard, hip check harder, Carter Beck. Oh my god, oh my god, oh my god! Jeremy, still unimpressed, yet oddly enough, holds one expected hand out to me. Can I help you? Where's mine? What? Why, jersey? You didn't relax. She pulls it out. He holds it up in front of his face and he reads, which sucks because now I can't see his expression. To Jeremy, don't be an asshole to your sister, Carter Beckett.
And the thing is, her brother loves it. Her brother is like, Carter Beckett signed my jersey.
Yeah, yeah. And they end up having this like love-hate relationship.
Yes, they do.
Yeah,
they don't. They hug like at the very, very end.
Yeah, like in every conversation, like Carter's kind of like a golden retriever, and Jeremy would be kind of standing there like a angry German Shepherd.
He wants to hate Carter, but and with good reason. You know, like he's concerned for his sister, but like he's a Carter Beckett fan when it comes to hockey.
And literally, his kid loves Carter. Yep. At some point, she's like, because he's awesome. He's like, what about your old man? She's like, but he's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. I loved it.
Yep.
Loved it.
Yeah.
All right, lady. Do you want to move on to the cons? I think ours might actually be the same thing.
I think we have a joint. Yeah. We have joint meat.
Yeah. Go ahead. Do you want to start?
Shared meat.
Yeah.
Gross.
Jenny calls Simon syphilis.
Yes, she does. I forgot about that.
Yeah. Sorry. Shared me.
All right. So I really did enjoy this book.
Very much.
It's just too long for me. Not what she said. It's just too long.
Bit. It's a little bit, yeah.
It's like 600 pages. It's a pot of plus.
Yeah.
Yep. It's just a lot.
Just a lot.
It's not like, first of all, Becca Mack's writing is very good and funny and witty and quick. Like the conversations that her characters have are quick with each other. And you don't feel like it's a chore to read it at all.
No.
But I just felt like by the time I hit the 80% mark, I was like, how much longer we got?
And we hadn't gotten to the main conflict either.
Yeah, we had not got, like, the huge conflict does not happen until, like, I don't know, 85 or something percent. Yeah. Like, it was just long.
Yeah. 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 Just a couple things that maybe we could trim.
Just tighten it up. Yeah. That's all.
Yep.
All right. But that's it. This book was very delightful.
I know. I agree. Completely. I mean, I really, really, really liked Carter. I didn't think I was going to, but I really did. Like he doesn't, that first page, that first like few paragraphs, you're like, gross. Gross. Yeah.
He is a different person after he meets Olivia.
Yeah. I mean.
And I love that it's dual perspective from that standpoint because, you hear it, you watch him realize that these changes are strange in his mind.
Yeah.
Like, he notices that they're weird. He notices they're different. And then he's like, but it doesn't freak me out.
Well, he does because he is very honest a number of times. He's like, I'm terrified.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. He's, but he's like willing to.
Oh, to overcome that before her. But he says a number of times, like, I'm scared. I know you're scared. He's like, you might be scared. And there's one point, he's like, you might be scared. He's like, I'm terrified of how much I care about you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And coming from like, from his perspective where he watched his mom like barely function as a human for 2 years.
Still is not.
I mean, 7 years later or however long it's been. Mm-hmm. And really like a lot like Viscount Who Loved Me in that regard. Like we're coming off of like two reform breaks, two heroes that don't want to get married and Anthony has to, but like they don't want to fall in love and like do all of that because they don't want to like leave the carnage behind. Which I get, like, on a very soul-crushing level.
All right, let's go back to happy things. So our bottom bombs.
I am in therapy.
Nice.
Yep, you're welcome. Also, my dog's playing with her fucking bell back there. God damn it.
She just went outside. I can watch from behind you.
She did. He just took her out.
She's like,
she's just playing with her bell.
Well, she's like, she's like, I need to give all these angels wings. Every time a bell rings,
an angel gets his wings.
Not a Christmas movie, guys. Not a Christmas movie.
Also, not A Wonderful Life.
No.
Or Happy.
No. Although
the movie is depressing as fuck.
It is
worth the tally mark.
Yeah. I do love Jimmy Stewart, though. Anywho. Really good guy in real life. Anyhow.
Bottom buns, would you like to go first?
Sure. Well, you know what? I don't want to steal yours. I don't know what yours is, so I don't want to steal yours.
Okay.
Yours are usually unique, but go for it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I try to, like, find something that is
not common.
That is not the reformed rake, but, like, I just couldn't help myself with this one. Okay, so one of the other things that I really loved about this book is the side characters, particularly the relationship that Carter has with his teammates.
Okay.
Because like his, like Emmett and Adam and Garrett, I assume, because this is a series, although we don't know how many there will be, I assume Garrett and Adam will also have books. Adam goes through some things in this book. Yeah. So I'm very excited for Adam to like get a happy ending one day.
Because he deserves it. He's a nice guy.
He really, really deserves it. He's apparently the youngest of all of them, but far, like most mature by far.
Yeah.
But like Garrett is clearly a bit of a playboy.
Mm-hmm.
Not like as much, I think, as Carter, but still like single and not interested in like settling down. I'm sorry, there's like a noise. I assume it's my dog just trying to get into things she's not supposed to be in. Anyway, I really like their dynamic, and multiple times when they're traveling, because they'll be gone for, you know, a few days at a time on like a road trip or whatever. And so Olivia and Carter try and FaceTime like as much as they can.
Mm-hmm.
And he insists that he watch her get dressed every morning. So she's like, it's kind of annoying, but I just do it because it makes him happy. And like, I don't, whatever, who cares? He's seen me naked a billion times. So she like sets her phone up on her dresser and then starts to get dressed. And she hears someone just call like, hey, Olivia. And then all of a sudden, Carter is like smashing the phone into his chest and is like, incoming, Olivia, get dressed, Olivia, incoming. And then there's like a shuffle for the phone and like lots of like jarring movements while she is frantically trying to put clothing on because she knows like someone else is coming in the room. You could also just set your phone down and like no one can see you, but beside the point.
Yeah.
At any rate, so then like Garrett is holding the phone and is like, hey, oh, not even a shoulder, you know? Like,
yeah.
They all know, and he has no filter. So he will make comments about like things he's gonna do to her later in yeah. front of everyone.
Yeah.
And she's always like, Carter, like, stop. At one point, they're in the playoffs. Yeah. So as they're getting closer to the Stanley Cup finals, he makes a comment about how, you know, how some people like eat cereal out of the cup. He goes, I am gonna eat. And she's like, Carter, she like smacks his, she like slaps her hand over his mouth. Cause they like, they're in public, there are people there.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like it might be his teammates or whatever, but she's just like, stop talking.
Yeah. He does it particularly in front of his family too.
Yes. In front of his family, even his mom. At one point, I think it's at one of the games. It might be like the final game.
He's giving the pep talk.
He's giving a pep talk, mm-hmm. and she is clearly turned on by it. And yep. even Kara, playing with a water bowl. Even Kara is turned on by it, and they're both like just staring at him.
Olivia says something about like, what did you know what she says?
What does she say? Like
something like, he's gonna get the.
I'm gonna let him do whatever he wants to me later, and. And, like, his mom is standing right there. And she, like, realizes,
and she's like, oh, I'm so sorry.
Yeah, and she's like, oh, my God, I'm so sorry. And she goes, his mom's name is Holly, and she just, like, shrugs and goes, I just want grandbabies.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I'm going to add on to that just because it leads into, then we can continue talking, but my bottom bun is actually his mom and his sister.
Oh my God, they are hysterical.
And I love their relationship. Like you said, all the side characters are really good and fleshed out. Like Jeremy's great, Kristen's great.
Yeah.
Jeremy and Kristen, Kristen is his wife.
Yeah.
But there is an exchange that I was smiling through the whole thing, and I have to read at least part of it because it is so funny. It's where he's in every time they call each other, like they can't just like talk. They have to be FaceTiming.
No, they're FaceTiming
all the time. If I was my boyfriend, I'd be like, fucking stop, all right? Like, and he does
swear
like,
jar.
He also talks to her while he's peeing too.
Yeah, he does
a lot. Like at one point,
I think he like leaves the phone. I think he left the phone in the other room and then he went and peed and came back.
Well, because she's like, at one point she says something like, "I'm worried about as much as how much he's peeing," something along those mm-hmm. lines. So anyway, he's on the phone with her and her mom and his mom. He's like picking his mom up to go to one of the dance recitals or whatever. Mm-hmm. And so she realizes that he's FaceTiming her. So
uh-huh.
Holly is losing her mind. Mm-hmm. Let's see. I had it. Where was it? Oh, shoot. Oh, okay. So mom comes skidding into the living room, breathless, both eyes finally done. She points at my phone and mouths, "Olivia? It's Olivia?" Then she jumps up and down, covering her mouth with both hands. She's 52, in case anybody's wondering, whether my mom is, in fact, an adult. And we still go for brother, because they're still talking. And then, let's see, then, where's it at? I'm sorry. My mom becomes a cat, clawing at my legs, nails digging. Okay. Yeah, I can't say the one before that because you'll find out what. Yeah. To warn a silent scream from me as I hide my phone and keel over, pushing her off of me. And then I turn. So where is the part where she's like scooting on her butt? That's the funny part where she's like, she's sitting there and she's like bouncing on her butt. Here I found it. She's like, those mocha eyes narrow dangerously before Olivia tips forward with a laugh. My mother's bouncing around on her ass, hands clapped behind her chin, beneath her chin. I hold my foot out, trying to shove her away. It doesn't work. She's too persistent.
At one point, he pushes her away with his hand on her face.
Yes. Oh my God! Very funny. Very funny. And like
she eventually, it ends with he calls her a nickname, like an endearing nickname.
Yeah,
like
we don't want to tell that. Yeah.
No, but. She his finally his mom just cannot control herself anymore, like cannot stay silent. And she just goes, "Oh my God," my mom shouts out, collapsing dramatically onto her back. She springs off the floor and pounces on me. "I can't help it, she's adorable." "Mom!" A power struggle promptly ensues. She tries to steal my phone. An elbow soars through the air, hammering me in the nose. She throws herself over my lap and grabs for my phone. "I just want to say hi. Give me the phone, Carter. Get your grabby hands out of here." I manage to get a hold of one flaily arm and pin it behind her back. She huffs out a heavy breath, blowing her bangs off her forehead with her famous mom scowl. The anxious giggle coming from my phone has both of our heads turning to find Olivia watching us in curious amusement.
Yeah, at one point, sometime later, Olivia goes, "I would totally watch a television show based on your family."
Yes, and he goes, one of them says, like, "We'd be the Kardashians. I'd be Kim, obviously."
Yeah, that was Carter, of course. Yes. And then he's got this, like, really, like, playful relationship with his sister, obviously. And mm-hmm. So at one point they're fighting because, like, Jenny has caught on to his feelings way, like, Carter's, like, barely keeping it together. And they're fighting. And so Olivia's like, "What are you two fighting about?" Nothing, I kind of sort of shriek. The look I pin Jenny with says she'll be the one with no eyebrows if she says anything. Well, it was supposed to be a surprise, but Carter was telling me he's finalized the details on our horse riding lessons for the spring. He thought you'd like to come with me. Horse riding lessons? I can't believe she's buying this shit. I gave exactly 1 month until Jenny tells her the entire blah, blah, blah. But, like, I guess Jenny had been trying to get him to get her horse riding lessons for, like, months. Yeah.
And eventually, he does.
He does.
And they take lessons later.
And she and Jenny's got this, like, so we're hoping. We don't know what Jenny, like, if Jenny's the next book. But Jenny could go either way, Adam or Garrett, because she's got this, like, sort of the same sort of relationship that Olivia and Carter have, but with Garrett. Mm-hmm. But then Adam's such a sweet guy. It would be interesting to see that kind of.
Yeah, but Adam also specifically says, like, "I'm not ready. I'm not ready."
No, but he's very flirtatious with her, too.
Winnie, can you stop? Please.
Yep. So this book's great, guys. It really is.
Yeah, it is really great. Especially, like, when things start to hit the fan with, like, Adam is going through a rough time. My God, Winnie. Adam is going through a rough time, and just, like, the way that the boys just rally around him and take care of him and watch out for him. It's just really sweet, because then the same thing happens. Like, when things start to hit the fan, I don't know what she got, with Carter, then they rally around him.
Right.
And it's just, like, it's really a beautiful friendship that all of them have. It's very sweet.
Right. It is. And she has put together some really good, Becca has really written some nice side characters. And like I said, if you've not read Love You Love
Setting Up for more books, clearly, but like, you know.
But and I think I've said before, and I will say this again, one of my favorite characters, especially like kid characters. Kid characters, and I've written this before in reviews, I can take them, like, either they're fine and I can ignore them, or I'm constantly like, oh my gosh, can you, like, don't speak. But Becca wrote this character in Love You Wild, and this kid is so freaking adorable. It's one of my favorite kid characters in any book. So she can write really good characterization. She does a really good job with that.
Yeah. Elena, Alana, however you pronounce her name.
She's cute.
She's funny.
Yeah.
She's real cute.
Yeah.
She is very funny. Yeah. So I enjoyed that.
Yeah. So right now we're going to switch over to our interview with Becca. So enjoy our titillating conversation. It's scintillating conversation.
Scintillating it might be.
I mean, I like both.
Titillating.
Did you find the place okay? Sorry, it's kind of loud for a Saturday morning.
Yeah, it's fine. Why are we at the park though?
Well, I wanted to start running drills.
Drills?
Yeah, like one-on-one passing.
Like soccer?
Yes! We need to hone up skills! Season's half over!
Wait, what is happening?
I figured we need to get in football shape for our new Ted Lasso podcast.
Okay, to be fair, it will take more than just this to get us in football shape. Also, I have a lot of questions.
Best way to understand the sport is to live it, right? Jason can use that in season 3.
Okay, legitimately, that's a really good line. But, right, we don't have time to start an offshoot podcast, and no one has time to edit it.
But that's the great thing about Anchor.fm. Anchor will do all of that for us in one little place, like our own little coach beard.
I know, that is one of the best things about Anchor. It's free, and the built-in tools allow us to record and edit your podcast right from your phone.
Plus, they'll distribute it to Spotify, Apple Podcasts, you know, so many of the other podcasting platforms. Wait, how good is your Roy Kent impression?
Why would I be doing a Roy Kent impression?
I've been working on mine. You want to hear it?
No, there's kids everywhere. Little ears don't need to hear the F word this early.
So we're not doing this?
No, honey.
Yeah. What am I going to do with all these soccer balls and goldfish?
I don't even want to know why you have actual goldfish.
To visualize being a goldfish. Will you take half of them?
I can't guarantee my kid's not going to kill him, but yeah, okay.
We're doing this.
I believe we are not doing this.
Oh, I believe we are.
No, but we're not, though.
Be curious, not judgmental!
Right, I'm not being judgmental. I'm being realistic.
Come on.
It's
barbecue
a great idea.
Sauce!
Oh, we don't have time. We just don't have time.
Onward!
You're starting,
forward!
No, you're starting a horror movie podcast with Charlotte. We don't have time.
I believe. Oh, God.
Welcome to the interview portion of this podcast. Today, we are welcoming Becka Mack, who wrote Consider Me. Becka is a steamy romance author, self-proclaimed sargasm queen, professional procrastinator, and a super fan of dragging her readers through hell and back on the way to a happy ending. Can confirm.
Yeah.
Welcome, Becka!
Yay!
Thank you for having me.
We're super excited that you're here, and we're grateful that you were able to take some time to be with us on this Saturday evening.
I don't have anything else going on, so.
I literally have no life. Don't worry about it. All right. We're all joking. We all laugh inside.
We're all dying inside. Okay, so.
All right, so.
All right.
Okay. I'm just going to start.
Yes.
Becka, you've heard the podcast before. What's your bright spot? If you have, I'm sure you have. You probably have. Yes.
Yes. You know what? Honestly, my son just started pulling himself up to standing.
Oh, that's so exciting.
It's so exciting. He's growing so fast. So I think that's my bright spot. And he's also started saying like his first word, and it is my dog's name.
Oh, that's kind of awesome / annoying, because it's not like mom.
I know. How many times do I have to say mom, 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 mom? And then he just looks at the dog and goes, Willy.
Oh, sorry to mean to laugh, but that's kind of
that's
funny.
Rude / awesome.
Yeah.
How old is he now?
He's 8.5 months.
Adorable.
Super cute.
Oh my God.
And all the times you post pictures, he's super adorable. So
yeah, I know.
You grew that one nice. He's real cute.
We approve of that bright spot.
I did. Mm-hmm. I did a good job.
You did.
He's got these like bright blue eyes, and me and my husband both do not.
Interesting. I mean, it's a recessive gene, so like someone in your family had blue eyes at some point.
My mom does have blue eyes.
So. Okay, there you go.
Yeah,
I didn't get to sing at you, Becca. I'm sorry. I said I didn't get to sing at you. Usually we sing it.
Yeah, we usually sing it.
It's all right.
Okay. I do feel robbed.
Well, Becca, tell me something good. Makes you feel any better?
Cute little baby. cute little baby.
Little baby.
Okay. So this one is mine.
Okay.
Which I wrote in a fury.
Oh, so, no question. You're referring.
Please tell me that Adam gets his own book and that Courtney dies miserable and alone.
Yeah.
It's very important to me.
With a stake in the heart, because that would be, she might be a vampire. Anyhow.
So I wrote this book on Wattpad originally 2 years ago. And the comment section when everything went down with Courtney was very violent.
Yeah, I'll bet.
Just thousands of comments detailing violence.
Oh, the internet? What?
I can't imagine that.
Well, they have to disable comments on most things? Yes.
I mean, let's be real though. Courtney kind of deserves it, maybe. Like, I'm not condoning violence against women, but like, she's a fake person. Okay. You guys, this is a fake character. So, like, if I have violent thoughts about her, I'm just not going to apologize for it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. If I want to throw punch her, I want to throw punch her. It's fine. No worries.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So please tell me Adam gets his own book and that he, like, okay, thank you, Jesus. Okay. Awesome. Yeah. Very excited.
I've got like such a sweet girl planned for him. So I'm really excited for his book. It's all plotted and everything. And I'll just like a little tiny tidbit is he's getting a single mom trope, which I feel like is just like perfect for him.
Oh, it actually
I think
is.
That'll be so good for him.
So that actually answers another question that we had.
Uh-huh.
Wait,
is it on there or do we just think about it?
No, I think we were just, I think we actually, we brought it up in the episode and we were like,
yeah, we did.
Which one? So we think that Jenny and Garrett, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. Okay.
Awesome. I figured it could go either way. Cause like Adam was kind of feeling it, but like, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
I did so really enjoy the wedding part where she was like, just fix your tie.
I like those tips. He's like, so I've written that book already and he's just like terrified of her.
Yes. I love it when grown men are terrified of women.
It's pretty amusing.
Well, we brought that up actually when you listen and we talk about Carter, how many times he said like, you might be scared, but I am terrified. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was very, well, you know, spoiler. One of my things was, I think he's very emotionally intelligent. For not having a boyfriend, or not having a boyfriend, a girlfriend for so forever. I mean, true. I mean, whatever.
There's no judgment here.
Nope. I will enjoy either way. Anyhow, how he's, you know, like, especially that fight, that the one fight, their first fight. And I'm like, whoa, for somebody who's not, like, not ever really been in a relationship, he gets people and he understands people quite well. So,
yes,
kudos to you for writing a very socially intelligent, emotionally intelligent hero. Very.
He was so much fun to write because he was just so clueless when it came to like certain parts of their relationship and, you know, navigating getting there, but like really emotionally in tune with Olivia. And I think with himself once he realized his feelings. Mm-hmm. So he was fun to write.
Well, you know, he's like, I'm killing it. And his boyfriend, I'm like, yeah, you are actually.
You actually are really kind of killing it.
Really good.
Yeah.
I loved the part where he was talking with the boys while they were out of town at one point, I think, about like whether or not she was really his girlfriend. And they were like, no, you have to like have that conversation. And he like internally starts freaking out and then texts her like, are you seeing other people?
That was funny. And then one of my favorite parts, I think it's from that same chapter, is a girl, like Emmett's like explaining to him, you know, you can't just let women like come around you and like touch you or whatever, like you
not just
normally
you anymore.
Would. Mm-hmm. And then a girl like tries to sit in his lap and he shoves her to the ground.
Yes,
and just screams, like, I have a girlfriend. Yeah.
Like we talked about how he was like walking around like this.
So I really funny. Just tried to make him as like obnoxious and like I don't know, like, ostentatious as, like, anything. Like, just, like, he loved attention, craved it, looked for it, like, brought it on himself.
Yeah. Yeah, but I think that, like, it's funny. Veronica, what's the other thing we're talking about? We're talking about, like, every time he knows how embarrassed she is, but, like, because of, like, I don't know if this could be true or not, is it seems like every time somebody would write something horrible about her, he would up his, like, his howl.
Flattery game.
Like, yeah, his ostentatious, like you just said, mm-hmm. ostentatiousness. He'd be like, I'm going to, like, do this at the game, and I'm going to do this. And he'd, like, just, like, prove even more, like, she is the real thing, and I want it.
Yeah.
And, again, that's very intuitive. I mean, he's great. Carter's pretty, he's a plus in my book.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely.
Yes.
Glad to hear that.
Yay. Okay, so you did throw it in there. You did. Okay.
Oh, of course I did. Okay. So this one. Oh, I already copied it. So this, I'm going to send in the chat a link to a pin because I'm just curious. We both chose this person without consulting each other for Carter.
You guys both did?
Mm-hmm. She sent me yesterday an article of, like, hockey players, like hot hockey players, basically. And I was like, oh, I'm this one. I choose this one. And she was like, okay, I wonder if we're going to choose. It's a hockey player, not an actor.
I'm excited to see.
So we're just curious if maybe this dude was your inspiration.
Are you sending the one with the dog?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Says I'm leaving Zoom.
Oh.
So I just want to, it's in another thing, but I just want to make sure it's, oh, hold on. Open link in a new tab. Okay, no, but.
What do you think? I mean.
He's pretty good. I gotta. It keeps.
We could just send you our Pinterest folder of all the pictures.
I know. Here you go.
He is real hot.
Mm-hmm. Right? So he's,
I don't even know if I know who this is.
I mean, I didn't until yesterday.
Swedish, right? Oh, okay, I do.
His name is Roman Josi or Yossi or something. I don't know. Mm-hmm. He is hot as hell. That is the reason that he is currently on this board. Oh, I don't even remember who he plays for.
If you go drop down below, there's a side profile picture of him and he is perfect.
So hot.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
he is a hot Swedish IKEA meatball. Let me just tell you. Right. He's Swedish or something, isn't he? I don't know.
No.
I think he is.
I think he is. Yeah, okay. Cool. You're changing my mind here. My Carter Beckett was totally Tom Wilson.
Hang on. I don't know who that is. Is he a hockey player?
He's a hockey player. He's like a big, huge fighter dude. And he's so cute. He
holy shit.
Did you look him up?
Yes. I think my ovaries exploded.
He's hot.
Fuck.
And like broody.
He gets into like a lot of fights. He's like the bad kind of guy in the NHL.
Yeah, there's going blood all over his face. How is that hot? Why is that hot?
We have
problems. I don't know.
His
birthday the other week, and he went to a animal shelter for his birthday and was like feeding tiny baby kittens, and I was like, okay, well, that's a thing that Carter would do.
Well, add that to your spank bank, Ray.
Currently, what? Here you go, y'all. You know, I'm sure y'all needed this in your life.
Oh my god.
Somebody's out getting that. Yeah, somebody's getting added to my spank body list. For God's sake!
Wow,
I haven't seen this picture.
Well, you're welcome, I suppose.
Selena Gomez?
What?
That's what Hollywood Life says. How old is this?
No.
Oh, this is 6 years. This is 7 years old.
Are you talking about? Who are you talking about?
It says Selena Gomez dating Tom Wilson, moving on from Justin Bieber.
I think he's been with his girlfriend for a really, really long time.
Okay.
But... you know the whole like gray track pants thing?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, of course.
Yeah. So, yeah.
I have like a group chat with my writing friends, and there was a video of him on Instagram the other day, and like his girlfriend was taking it and he was just in the background and he was wearing the gray track pants. And I was like, he's holding these kittens or these puppies. And all I'm looking at is the gray track
pants. Are the gray pants. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Of course. Why would you look anywhere else?
You should come with a disclaimer.
You could see a lot.
What should gray sweatpants?
Like, yes. Yes. Be like, you are going to be turned on by these. You don't know why, but you do know why. You, Even like they're he was super young, he's super cute. Like, Oh my God. All right. So,
that's a good picture. That second one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is.
Okay. I can look at these pictures. Like, this is how stunt casting goes. We sit and we're like,
hey, yeah, so, this is how stunt casting goes every single time.
And it's quiet for like 2 minutes. We're just like,
Yeah. We're like, this is good podcasting.
Yeah.
Radio a non-visual awesome. App to just have silence.
Where the two women are just getting horny looking at pictures. Awesome.
Oh, I forgot to tell Mr. Veronica that you gave me presents today.
I don't know if Becca wants to know about those presents. Anyhow,
I think Becca can probably deduce. Anyway, all right.
This is very fun.
Oh, God.
Thank God.
Yeah. We're too hot to handle, too cold to hold.
Wow.
I did see another glass of wine.
Yes, I'm actually probably gonna have Mr. Veronica bring me more.
I have the big bottle.
He can pull double duty. It was some TikTok sound, and it was like, we followed you today, by the way. I didn't realize you had a TikTok.
I'm just figuring out how to use it.
Same. I'm an elder millennial. So
yeah. I literally just screen record pieces from my other podcast and use it on TikTok. That's all I do for TikTok for. Because I'm like ancient. I'm like, you know, a mummy of TikTok. There you go.
Well, it's lovely that what seems to be the trend is just flipping through your book right now.
Yeah. Yeah,
because I don't want to show my face. I don't want to have to do any of those acting.
You know what? Honestly, you don't have to. Like, look at. Have you read anything from Lauren Asher?
I haven't. She's on my TBR.
Oh my God, she is so good. So I've read half of her race car series, the
Third Gear. I think
it's Formula One series or whatever.
I think it's called.
Okay, yeah. So I read series. Throttled and
these Collided. Ones, I was collided. Fun of you.
Yeah, I read the first two, Throttled and Collided. Yeah. I have not read Wrecked or Redeemed, only because like things got busy. Like, I want to read them, and I have not read either of her Dreamland series yet, but I want to really bad.
I really want to read the Terms and Conditions.
Yeah, same. But anyway, my point is, in her TikTok, she doesn't show her face like ever. Yeah. She only like. Shows her flipping through books or taking books off the bookshelves or something like that. So there's plenty of precedent for that. Yeah. So like, if you want examples, like look at her stuff.
FYI, your dog is out behind you. He's literally asleep. He came in to do his own little solo.
What is your dog's name?
Oh, Willie.
Oh, Willie. Right. That's right. Oh my God.
he came into the frame and he was like,
Free Willie.
Yeah. Oh God. Carter should have said that.
You know what? She's writing two more books, so I'm sure she can slip that in there.
Oh, that's what she said. Anyhow.
That was good. That was good. Tip of a hat to you.
Tally ho. I think your question is next.
All right. So next is, we were just wondering what your writing process is like. Do you have like a setup that you use? Do you have to light a special candle? Like, I literally know an author who's like, I need to have my special candle lit. And I was like, oh, that's cool.
This is church. Quills? What's happening? Church.
Anyway, do you have like a setup? Do you have, like a ritual, or are you just like, I have 15 minutes before my kid wakes up from his nap?
So I feel like it's changing all the time. Even just now, halfway through writing my last book, it changed just because I got a desktop computer and I was like, well, now I have to put this somewhere and now I have to write in front of that spot. I used to literally just, I started writing just before like the COVID shutdown. mm-hmm. In 2020. And then because I teach kindergarten, and at the time when they closed the schools, there was nothing for us to do. They weren't putting us online. So I was literally just hiking every day with my dog. And I don't know why, but I'd be like hiking through the woods and I'd be like, oh, imagine this happened.
I love it.
Totally. So then I'd like get home and be like, I just gotta jot down these ideas on my laptop before I forget. And then it would all of a sudden I'd have like 7 chapters written of this book when I was trying to work on another one. But I literally just used to like set up shop at my kitchen island and write all night long. And now obviously it's different. It's a lot harder to find time to write. And then when I have time to write, my brain's like, no, we're just gonna sleep or like lay there and stare at the ceiling.
I get that.
Yeah, it's like, it's nice now to have this little, like, I'd love to have like a little office space, but we don't have the room for it. So I'm just got a desk set up here in my bedroom. And it's nice to have this space, but it's funny because we were having trouble getting my son to sleep for a while there. Mm-hmm. So I'd get him to sleep.
I'm not shocked. Not shocked.
I'd get him to sleep and then I'd come into my room and start writing. And then like 20 minutes later, he'd be awake. So my husband would like take over. And then when he'd get him down, he'd come in here to just like wait to see if he'd actually go down, and he'd just be laying across the bed on his phone. And I'm like, this is really awkward. I cannot write smut scenes while you're laying next to me, just staring at your phone. So I would just stare at him until he would leave.
I cannot think about another hot guy while you were laying right next to me.
No, so I can't.
I want to try out everything I'm writing. Thank you.
Yeah, but later. Come back.
Yeah,
right. Yeah. I want to see if this works. Can we, the logistics of this, can we work on it?
Honestly, I was reading how to write a better smut scene like a while ago.
Wait, and what? Can I have this article, please?
I'll look for it again. Okay, anyway, I was reading that and one of the tips was legitimately like, try it out. I was like, yeah. Because they were saying like how you're describing like logistics of where hands are and like, like that matters, you know, the where, you know, if you literally see if this is possible, which I feel like it's very apt when you're talking about reverse harems. Like I've read a singular reverse harem and every single time, like it would get to a sex scene, I'd be like, necks don't bend that way, man. Like I understand why you think that that's going to work.
Well, I was going to say, if you need inspo, I got some cards for you.
Oh, yeah. No, we won't foray into that. I think that the fact that I also write, and so everything that I read is like, it's just a matter of like literally putting words on the page, because it's easier to adapt what you have than start from nothing. So like you were saying, you know, you're hiking with the dog and you're like, what about this? And then all of a sudden I have 7 chapters written, you know, like I think that's really great. I love that.
You know, I was listening to a podcast the other day. They were talking about this author was in there and she was actually talking to one of the hosts and he had written a book and they're both talking about the horror of the blank page and like how, like she was saying, I will literally like, she's like, I organized a linen closet. Wasn't my linen closet, but I did it just so that I didn't have to write like the things that like, I just needed to like it, but staring at a blank page is just not inspiring either.
And
it's intimidating. And it's sitting there just staring at you. Like you should be writing anything.
There should literally be words anything. Here, literally anything.
And the host had said like that he actually wrote, it's going to be okay. Like that's what he wrote. And he's like, no, it's not going to be okay. I need to write some fucking words, but yeah.
There you go.
I had a really hard time writing the next book in this series, which is called Play With Me, because Garrett's supposed to be kind of like really shy around Jenny, Carter's sister, and she's Carter's sister, so she's really like Carter in female form, not shy at all, and super loud. And I had
Simon Syphilis. My, yes.
The fact that he called him different names was my favorite thing.
Steve, who are you sleeping with tonight?
Yeah. He calls him Steve throughout Jenny's book as well.
Yes.
I don't think he ever actually calls him Simon.
That's okay. Simon doesn't deserve it.
He doesn't deserve a real name.
No, there I like go. Simon Syphilis, honestly.
I do too.
Yeah. But sorry, I derailed. I apologize. Yeah.
That's okay. I don't remember.
But you said go ahead.
You were writing the second book and you were having trouble. Garrett has to be like
shy
yeah, around yeah. Jenny.
I did not know how to write a shyer guy.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know. I just I couldn't get it to work, and it took me weeks to get into it. And then at one point I just stopped and I just chapter outlined everything. And I have mm-hmm. never written a chapter outline before for any book.
It's tough, isn't it?
Which is why my books are so fucking long. Where's my first swear? That's my first one.
There you go. Oh my God, that was your first one.
Yeah.
Well, for fuck's sake, crank it up, bitch. I bitch lovingly. It's
Earlier, she texted me when we decided we were going to do this again tonight. She texted me and she was like, well, let's do it up, bitch. And I was like, yeah, let's fuck it up.
A couple weeks ago, we were recording and I said something about, she said something. I go, well, listen, asshole. And then I felt bad for the whole rest of the episode about how I called an asshole.
I know you do. You're not being mean. It's not a malicious thing.
Yeah, okay. But now I've got, oh my God, guys, I am at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. I am a lot of money. All right, I'm at 60 bucks.
You got 40 more until you hit your threshold. So,
okay.
I'm surprised that's all you've got.
Becca.
Becca is burning you to the ground.
I know. Fucking solid burn. Damn it. Okay.
I love you.
Okay. All right. We can move on. Who are you? Some of your literary influences? Is there a book that got you into romance, or have you just always loved reading romance?
I've always loved reading romance. In high school or when I was a teenager, I always read that. I stopped reading for a while, and then right before 2020 I was I have to read, I'm just so bored. And I picked up Helena Hunting, her Pucked series.
Yeah, I read the first one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and actually I don't think the first one is the best one. I think the third one is amazing.
Oh,
the
okay.
first one is that sounds so mean. The first one is great, but I liked the third one so much, loved it. But I literally read this book and I was oh my God, romances are allowed to be funny? I didn't realize books could be funny.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I just I fell down this deep hole of I hadn't read in years. And then all of a sudden I was reading everything she had written and then finding other people and similar books. And then I was kind of I feel like I could do this.
I love that.
I do. I love that.
Well, you can. So FYI, yeah, you can.
Obviously you can. So there's that.
But I think there's something also, I think people hate on romance so much. And I think I hate to say, that's why I think my reviews are so long, just because I want to pull everything out that shows that it's not just romance novels are not just let's throw some private parts together and smush them and that's it. There's underlying things especially we talked about earlier. There's just, emotional intelligence. There's just things that I can pull out from every book that could be applicable in any setting. And I think that people just kind of downgrade romance for just being fluff. And I'm it's really not. There are some quite staid sort of themes that go into any sort of romance novel. Mm-hmm. So
and you know what? Even if it is just fluff, it takes a lot to put those words on a paper and make them make sense.
Right. And I think easy. Exactly. And I think you can make connections to anything with it doesn't matter if it's fluff. I can, there's something in my life that I probably can relate to that.
Exactly.
To me, it's
I think there's also something that that we've talked about on the show is I love reading romance because it's good for my anxiety.
Like, yes. Even when there's tension, I know, like, well, this is a romance novel. So, like, at the end, they're going to end up together.
You know? Okay, well, you guys are going to hate me. I have
probably not
terrible anxiety. That's another one of the reasons that I started writing, because I was just like, I need to, like, find something.
Mm-hmm. She's an outlet. Yeah. yeah. I have to fight with my big bottle.
I didn't know it was this kind of party, so I'm over here with the glass of water, which feels not right.
Well, you should probably text your husband and be like, "Hi, bring me wine."
Sommelier, hello.
Hello. Is your husband a sommelier?
No, I'm just saying a sommelier just because.
Okay. That's anyway, sorry, wine. We derailed you. Okay, start over. So we're not going FYI, to hate you.
No, because the both of us have severe anxiety.
We have severe anxiety. We are both medicated for our anxiety.
Yes.
So I like when I get to that, I know it's a happy ending, but when I get to that part of a book where like it looks like there's no happy ending in sight, I flip to the epilogue.
Oh,
there is nothing wrong with that. Becca,
I do.
There's nothing wrong with that.
And then go back to the rest of the book.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that. It's
no,
okay.
I get this. No, I get this. I am the same. I didn't get, and I mentioned in our Bridgerton, we talked about Bridgerton before we started this interview, but that's why I did not like this second season, because I don't like angst. I call it car crash angst. Like, yeah. There's like, I just cannot. Everyone's like, you, like people like, I can't
and
stop
you
watching.
Like, I love
like,
you wild.
At one point she did tell me like there's more angst than I'm accustomed to and Loved You Wild, but I love that book. And I was like, okay. Yeah. Because I'm the one who's like, I'll take the angst because like, I don't know, I find it kind of relatable. Like I have not had good examples of healthy relationships in my life. And so like to have people like see those issues, work through them and come out on the other side, I love that. Like to me, that's relatable to be able to see an issue, work through it. And like, it's not a catastrophic failure. Like, move on. You're stronger for it.
No. And yes, I mean, it was very hasty, but you can also think that like my purview for the most part is historical romance. So that's also like where
that's
my brain
that's
is
her preferred.
Oh,
that's
okay.
That's my genre. So if I can make it, that everyone can make it. Like, no, but like television shows in particular, that's what I don't like. Because a book, again, like you said, I can flip to the end and figure out what it is. A television show, I ain't waiting for next week.
Yeah.
I'm just going to be like, sorry, no, I'm done here. Like,
I just watched Schitt's Creek, not an angsty TV show.
But
at one
Schitt's
point,
Creek.
I was like, pausing, do Ted.
Oh, yeah, I know. I know exactly what you're talking about. Yep.
Yep.
Even like after that happened, I was like, but they're really not going to get back together.
I was so upset. Like, okay, well, they're going to fast forward in the last episode. They're going to show him showing up at her apartment in New York. Mm-hmm. And then I was like, okay, they really didn't do that.
Yeah.
No,
but there is something beautiful in their breakup that like they have both grown as people and they both still love each other. And they just recognize like our lives are growing the other way. And like this relationship isn't working anymore.
Yeah.
You know, it's just like, oh God, it was like heartbreak. I cried. Cried.
Oh, me too. I didn't expect to get so emotionally invested in the show.
I know. The show was so good.
Veronica knows how obsessed I am, and she is too. But I think maybe a little bit more, because I actually was gonna get a tattoo of the show on my body today.
Yes.
I'm obsessed with Ted Lasso. So my biggest fear is that season three, there's going to be angst. I mean, is certain angst up a little bit, but I have a feeling that it's going to be like angst galore. And I'm going to be like, I can't handle this. I'm going to lose my mind.
Okay. But here's what you need to keep in mind. Then think of it like a romance novel. By the end, it's going to be fine. Cause it's going to be the end of the show. They're only doing three seasons.
Right. That's true.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So this will be the final season. Everything will get tied up nice in a neat little bow. It'll be fine. Trust in Jason Sudeikis. It'll be all right.
I have to watch that show. So.
It's very good.
Oh,
10 out of
so
10
good.
Recommend.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It'll make you feel good. It's so positive. Yeah. And I think that's why I'm like, I don't want any angst because it is so positive.
Yeah.
It's like what everyone needed.
Like a good thing.
It's like such a positive, beautiful show.
Yeah.
I did buy, I want to say it was not based off of him, but I bought that one Christmas book.
Window Shopping?
And the but I'm very particular, and I got past Christmas and I was like, well, now I can't read this till next December.
That's fair. Yeah. We did read it in December for Christmas.
Yeah.
And we did an episode.
We did an episode on it. So if you're interested. Been
you guys who convinced me to read it, to be honest with you. But like he was compared to Ted Lasso, right?
Her face. I liked it more than rated.
I did not care for it.
Yeah. She didn't love it all that much. I didn't mind it as much. Like, I liked it. I read it and enjoyed it. And I have continued to read Tessa Bailey. Like, I read It Happened One Summer, which is based off of Alexis Rose from Schitt's Creek.
Right.
I liked it, obviously, very, very based on Alexis Rose. But
like, yeah. To the point where I was like, this is intellectual property. That's where I was at. I was like, okay, I don't.
I haven't read that one.
Yeah,
I did like it. Okay. I was surprised. I didn't actually think I would like it as much as I did, but I did.
I've gone back and forth on it so many times because of the way, I think her name is Piper, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How she's described, and I'm like, yeah, I don't know if I want to, like, I did find Alexis so like entertaining, but mm-hmm. I was like, I don't know if I want to read.
Yeah.
Because like, I don't know if I'll connect to that type of character.
That's yeah. Surface Thank level, you. I probably exactly. would
find something.
Mm-hmm. That was 100% my thing. I was like,
listen,
I
I'm not going to lie. Like that's different. Like when I started reading it, I was like, this is annoying. Like you are annoying. But I also think that is part of her character journey is that yeah. she is growing as a person and
yeah.
changing.
Yeah.
And Which she does sense. Transform. During yeah. the course of that book. So, I mean, I did enjoy it more than I thought I would. I am absolutely going to read the second one, which came out maybe early last month, called Hook, Line, and Sinker, about her sister, Hannah, who is very much, it's a big part of, she's a big part of that book.
That one appeals to me more than the
first. Yeah, Hannah is more down to earth. Like she's not as, she does work in movie production. So like she's in the industry, but she likes being behind the scenes. She is not, right. she doesn't so like being in the limelight.
We had a guest on for that episode and it's my co-host for my other podcast. And she texted me, I said, well, how, and she's like, I finished the book. I said, well, how you feel? She's like, it's not a book. I said, this is window shopping. I was like, and then when I read it, I was like, yep, that's, I mean, there was nothing there. That was where I was at that one. There was just nothing.
There's like, less like plot points.
Yeah.
It's a very small book, right? Because I bought
yeah,
that.
It's not, yeah. It's like,
and yeah. I got this, it and I was yeah. like, oh, this is tiny.
Yeah. yeah. That's what I thought. Yeah. Yeah. yeah.
So I mean, it was like fine. Just a fluffy story type of thing.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of like, it doesn't take place over a long period of time. Like it's over
literally a week.
It might be like two. Oh. It's a short period of time yeah. because I think she meets him like, I mean, I think the entire thing takes place in December. Within the month of December.
It's literally, if it's not a week, it's 2 weeks. It's like, that's it. Which is fine. I mean, like you can do a lot. I mean, obviously historical romance, you can do a lot in days. but no, I just, it was not my cup of tea, but, and she, like it was, the writing was fine. It was just not yeah. my cup of tea plot wise.
Yeah.
A phrase we love on the show is stolen from Amy Poehler, but we have a credit to her, is good for her, not for me.
Yep.
We talk about that all the time, that it's like, you know, we're yeah. not all going to like the same things, and that's okay.
Yeah. Nope. Yeah, that's true.
Speaking of, we are taking up all of your time. Okay. So, all right. So you have a playlist for this book. Is that, yes. which, by the way, points all around.
Yep.
Lots of points.
We love playlists.
We love playlists. Also, we have a love-hate relationship with John Mayer in that we okay. love his music and hate him.
No, that's no. Okay. Let's reframe that. You do. I don't because of a certain person that I don't.
I was going to say, are you a Swiftie? Is that why?
She is.
Oh, I'm absolutely a Swiftie. But so, it's not. That's not why I don't like him. He's kind of a dick.
He is kind of a dick. But it's, I mean, like that's
why I like him. That's why I was attracted to him in the first place. You know this about me.
I thought it was because of Taylor Swift. Okay, yeah.
No. I mean, that didn't help, but like, no, that actually has very little bearing on the fact that I know John Mayer. Okay. I don't know John Mayer, but I don't, what I was trying to say was, I know that he is not an awesome person is what I'm trying to yeah. say. Like yeah. there are enough media reports.
Anymore has been like, kind of like gone into the, he's older now. I mean, like, he's older than me.
He's in his 40s, I think.
Yeah, he's older than me, thank God. But like,
he's extremely talented.
He is. I love when he makes fun of Dave Matthews.
Slow dancing in a burning room is one of my favorite songs.
I have listened to that song about 100 times this week. Thank you.
Yep.
Yeah. In fact, twice today, once dancing with the dog. I'm good enough to admit that.
I'm angry you didn't send me video of that.
Poor Luna was like, she looked sad, so I danced with her. We were slow dancing in a not so burning room. Anyhow.
Okay. Sorry. So is this a thing that you do when you're writing? Do you use music while you're writing for like inspiration or guidance, or like, do you use music when you write?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Like I would say like a lot of my ideas from a song. So like actually Consider Me was originally named Good For You. And then, like, his Carter was like, oh, you know, maybe I'd be good for you. And of course, because he's arrogant.
Yeah.
And then I heard the song. Like, so I had written, like, half of it. And I had had him saying, like, you know, I just want her to consider me and stuff. And then I heard the song Consider Me by Alan Stone. And I was like, oh, my God, this is made for them. But, like, 100%, sometimes I just listen to a song and I'm like, yes, like, and it helps me like get through an issue or whatever. Sometimes I need total silence to write, but a lot of the times just having it on, like, I don't know, musical artists are like geniuses, so the way like they word everything, like, it's very helpful to listen.
I agree. I love songs that.
I think I
think it can help people get into like the mindset or like the mood of what they're trying to write.
Yeah. So actually one of my writing friends is writing an entire Taylor Swift series. Each book is going to be based off of one Taylor Swift song.
I'm literally sold. How do I pre-order the entire thing? We can discuss this at a different time. Maybe after we press stop, but like,
I think there was an episode where we talked about Taylor Swift when I said Spotify actually like won't let my Spotify won't play Taylor Swift.
She has like a block on it because she doesn't
really.
She
wow,
ridiculous.
Ridiculous. I just can't. I mean, I love.
Excuse me. Yeah. While I show you, this is a red water bottle, and I'm not sorry.
Love it. I've seen her a couple times. I fell in love with her. I'm a big country music fan, so I fell in love with her like back in her early days. And then for the first couple albums she did post country, and then she kind of fell off the map for me, but the last two albums have just been like fire. So
Evermore and Folklore.
Yeah. So
Reputation is underrated. It did not get the recognition it deserved.
Yeah.
Hair flip.
She's a fantastic artist too.
She's extremely talented. I mean, like, she just is. I could talk about her all day. Yeah. Okay.
Yes, she has.
And I could go into heavy detail, and indeed I will.
Guess what? I love you. It's fine. No worries. Mm-hmm.
I finally gave you your Christmas present today. I'm so good. Okay. So, who is your ultimate romance novel hero? Can you even choose?
Like, we have Mr. Darcy, obviously.
Obviously. Duh.
If you read any Penny Reid, Drew Ruin Me for All Men.
We call him Drew Ruin Me for All Men because he does indeed ruin us for all men.
And Jack Devlin from like Lisa Claypaws, you know. Yeah. If we're talking about like historical. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, historical. I don't know.
But like Drew Ruinous is not a historical. Book four in the Knitting in the City series.
Like, or Josh Templeman, you know, something.
Yeah,
like
Joshua Templeman from The Hating Game.
Okay, like I haven't read those series. I'm awful because I haven't
you're not
done
awful.
A lot of reading in the last year.
No, honey.
Oh, I can't imagine why. What have you been doing?
Right? I mean, you know, just teething a baby. It's fine. Another human. It's whatever. It could be something like Mr. Darcy was for me because when I was 15 years old, I discovered Pride and Prejudice, and it was like, oh, this is what men should be. So like, that's, so for you, what is that, that romantic hero? Who is like the romantic hero in literature for you? It doesn't have to be like a romance novel now. It could be like whatever that you've come across.
Okay. Well, honestly, I don't know that he's like a hero though. He's more anti-hero. Is that okay?
That's completely fine. Okay.
I just, like, not that long ago, a few months ago, read the Maid series by Danielle Laurie.
Okay, so I have not read them, but I've seen them everywhere. Okay, go ahead.
The Sweetest Oblivion, the first guy, Nico Russo. I was like, I don't know what's going on with this book. This guy is the hottest guy I've ever read in my entire life. And I absolutely adored, like, the fuck out of that book. It was so amazing.
Tally mark for you.
Yeah, I know.
Tally ho.
Tally ho. So amazing. The writing was awesome, but he was just like next level hot. Everything about him was perfect. And he was like, I don't know. I love that like obsessed boy trope.
Yeah.
And like, I mean, hurt her and you'll die type of thing.
This isn't like what they made that show The Maid into, right? Recently. This is something different.
I don't think so.
I will take that. I think she's still writing the series.
I'm going to look it up. Okay.
Keep going. Yeah, The Sweetest Obsession or The Sweetest Oblivion.
Sweetest Oblivion is that one, yeah.
There's like three of them, I think.
There's three. I think she's coming out with a fourth one.
Okay.
Yeah,
people are obsessed with that series. I just haven't, you know, like there are so many. So many novels.
There's so many books out there. Like, I know everyone's all into Erin Blackford. I've got the book. Mm. I haven't read it yet. I really want to read it. I want to be obsessed with him.
You would like to be The Sweetest Obsession? Yes, I got it.
Yeah, so I don't know. I think that's what I'd have to say for right now.
I like it.
I also don't get like so super attached to books. Like, I'm normally able to like move on to a new one pretty quickly.
What's that like?
I don't know. Like, I don't know how that happened to me because I think I have a pretty obsessive personality. But this book, I'm telling you, that's the only reason I say Nico Russo is because I had a major book hangover after that book.
Okay, so is that your favorite romance novel?
I would say, I don't know, probably, right?
Fair
like
enough.
Currently, right? Like, for a long time, it was Pucked Over by Helena Hunting.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Which is the third one in her series because I like a little bit of angst as well. In my stories, and the first one was like too lighthearted. Like, I want to have my heart broken a little bit.
No, what? I'm kidding.
I don't know what to tell you. I don't know. Talk to my therapist about it.
I need to. I like to cry.
What? I got ASPCA commercials. Thank you very much. I mean, I laughed because I was like, Olivia, you fuck rule. Because I, damn it.
Yes! I did like, at the end when he brings it up to her again, and she's like, it was horrible. It was so difficult to watch. Oh,
I literally just the other night, I was watching something and something came out. I'm like, nope. I wasn't even paying attention to the television. I was like, nope.
Awful. Oh my God. I'll tell you.
I will adopt all those babies. Okay. Anyhow. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I know.
I get it. Do you have a favorite? You said you like Helena Hunting. So is she like your favorite romance author?
Like, I honestly don't know if I have a favorite because I mean, they all do things that I like really love and then books that I'm kind of like meh about. Well, and she's my favorite lighthearted read for sure. Because I would say her books are more on the lighthearted side. She's got a book out called Little Lies, which is actually a college romance. And typically I'm like not college. But
I get it. Same.
Yeah, that one was more, I don't want to say darker because it wasn't dark, but it revolved a lot around like mental health issues. And it was just more angsty. And I loved that one so much, actually. But for the most part, like, she's my favorite lighthearted romance author.
So fair. That's fair. All right. So what are your desert island picks, though? If you had, if you were able to bring, if you, a potato is already factored in, as is Harry Styles.
Okay.
What would you bring to a desert island?
I'm bringing my son because I'm absolutely obsessed with him. Like, that's fair. Healthy, obsessed.
Yes. Makes sense. Makes sense.
If you want, that can be a gimme. Like, he was already with you.
Yeah.
You
know? Yeah. So yeah.
He's attached.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Oh, fair. My God, this is hard.
No, it's difficult. And it could be like a book. It could be a television show. It could be a, I'm like expanding it for you. Good. Books.
Could be a
television show. It could be a movie. It could be whatever you'd like.
It's a difficult question.
It is.
I know. I'm so glad I asked it.
I don't want to call myself simple because I'm a pretty complex person, but I don't like do like I don't watch TV really a lot or movies. I'm pretty much just reading, writing, and eating.
Same. I get it.
Word.
So I don't know. I definitely need some chocolate.
Okay. Fair. We'll take that.
Is the Kindle a gimme? Because
it is, because that's what is gimme? That is
that's what will charge the kid. That's what'll the potato. Yep. That's how it gets charged. I feel like you have to, like, a Kindle is just it's you have to bring the Kindle because then you can have lots of books.
Yeah, exactly.
You don't have to choose one. So.
Got
yeah, the exactly. Yeah. Now the question is the internet. Like, you need to be able to have access to the internet.
Can I ask the question of the three people or the two people? Well, two people, because I know what my answer is on this call. So I read most of my books on my phone, on my Kindle app on my phone. Do you guys actually like? I have Kindles. I have like legit like, but I don't use them. Do you guys do you read on your phones or do you read on Kindle like the actual like physical?
So for me, I actually don't have a Kindle. I have an iPad. So I have a Kindle on my iPad.
Got it.
But I flop back and forth between my phone and my iPad.
Got it.
For reading. Yeah.
I go back and forth between my Kindle Paperwhite and my phone. Yeah. Now, I really try to read on my Kindle, like, because the Paperwhite itself, like, there's no blue light.
Okay.
So, like, if I'm reading at night, before bed, like, you know, if you're supposed to be not having blue light in front of you.
All my back, my background's all dark. So I do dark.
I'm always in dark mode.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know that it really matters, but I do find that like it's easier on my eyes to be on my paper white.
Just a random question. Sorry.
I think it's fair.
Okay.
Can we talk about the Oreos?
Okay. I literally don't know. I just feel like everybody's got like that food that's like their comfort food. Well,
in Love You Wild, I mean, I remember like my review making a comment about strawberries. If there's like strawberries freaking everywhere, like because of strawberry beer.
Yeah, so actually in Love You Wild, they where Claire grew up, I guess is I base that like out of here. And there's I basically base that brewery that they work at out of a brewery here.
Nice.
And they've got strawberry beer and it's so fucking good.
And
it's
you said you've not read The Hating Game, right?
No.
Oh, what? Girl. Oh, you girl. Should. You should.
Is it, okay, this
strawberries
is by
are a thing. What? It's by Sally Thorne.
Oh, what am I thinking of?
They just made a movie out of the Hating Game.
Anna is Twisted, isn't she?
Twisted
the
is...
The Hating Game is the one that's the movie with Lucy...
Hale. With Lucy Hale.
I haven't watched that.
And what's his face, who's super hot.
Yeah, something. But there's a whole thing about strawberries in it.
Yeah, so. There's strawberries throughout.
Yep. Oh. Mm-hmm.
Okay. You would actually, I think she'd love that. I think
you'd like it. It's also enemies like to lovers. Romance. It is an office romance. It's very good.
Enemies to lovers. Yeah. It's like, it's enemies to lovers. So almost literally the last page.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Yeah.
But do they hook up throughout?
Oh, yes.
Well, there's a lot of tension that builds up. Yeah. And the sex scene, there's one like major sex scene. It is two actual chapters.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I mean, it is 10,000% worth it.
Bumping that up my TBR.
Yeah, you absolutely should. Yeah. But tension.
See, yes. That needs to be there for me in an enemies to lovers.
It's very good.
Yeah.
You will not be sorry.
Yeah. Okay. I there was a couple points where like, I don't like angst. The first time I read it, there was a couple times I actually cried. There was a couple times. Yeah, I can't. I cannot get past that. There was a couple times I cried because he was, I was like, well, you can't be mean to this girl. Like that's where, yeah. I mean, but he's not, you realize he's not being mean, but he is being mean. I think I would totally recommend. Anyhow.
Ooh, okay. Yeah. That was a good one.
What did you watch the movie?
Yeah, we did watch the movie and we did an episode on it.
Yeah.
How'd you feel about the movie?
The movie's not bad. Yeah. I mean, it's a pretty good representation. There were a couple things that I would recommend reading the book first.
Okay. Exactly. Yeah.
There were a couple things that they changed.
Watch the movie after.
I don't know. It's still a pretty good representation.
No, I don't think you will. I think there's like, you'll be like, I think the saddest part was the sex scene where they were like, and the elevator scene. There's two scenes that you're like, you're going to be disappointed at. I'm just going to tell you ahead of time, spoiler. But I think there's other pieces that actually make up for. There's some things that make sure And also Austin Stover. I don't know.
He's hot.
I don't know. He's gorgeous.
What else?
Climbed him like a fucking tree.
I don't remember. I'll look it up for you. I will also say that their elevator. They kiss in an elevator for the first time. Austin Stowell is his name. They kiss in an elevator for the first time. That is the hottest kissing scene I have ever read in my entire life.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean,
it's pretty incredible.
Okay.
Yeah.
Worth it. I've written this down so I can remember.
You're welcome.
So I think we talked about the playlist. So I'm going to skip over that one a little bit.
Yeah. Go for it.
So, as somebody who read Love You Wild, are we going to get a Wyatt book? Please tell me we're going to get a Wyatt book.
Yes.
Yay!
But to be honest with you, like, I don't know when it's coming. Cause like I had a plan to do a Charlie and a Casey book.
Right.
And then Wyatt.
Mm-hmm.
But I just don't like mentally feel there in that series.
I mean,
to do it for Ray.
I think I just got so far away from them because I buried myself in what happened was like that was the first book that I really wrote, and then I buried myself in Consider Me, and Consider Me is the book that really took off.
Yeah.
And where I actually felt like I kind of found my voice and my style and like where, like my niche, I guess. Mm-hmm. And then I went from Consider Me to the first book in my baseball series, which is like a lot like the hockey series and that it's like a big group of friends and it's a lot of fun and stuff. But the overall themes are heavier. And I totally got lost in that series too.
Mm-hmm.
And then I need more detail. Are they out? Can I read them?
No, so the baseball one, I was going to release this, June. My editor is going on mat leave at the end of summer. So she only has basically time to, edit one last book for me before she goes. And I've decided to go with the hockey one just so that it follows so promptly.
Damn, baby's ruining my timeline.
Gareth's story opens at the end of Consider Me. Like, it opens at the wedding. So it literally just, like, picks right back up where we start. So I just felt like it was important.
Wait, which wedding? At
Carter and Olivia's. Okay. Like, at the epilogue there.
Okay.
Yeah.
I will accept that as a consolation prize. Baseball is my favorite sport.
I've had to push off the baseball one, but the baseball one is like sad. It's a really beautiful love story. It's actually like a kind of love at first sight, which I know a lot of people
I love it so hate. I love it.
And I don't mean this like in an arrogant way, but I feel like I really nailed it.
I love that.
I'm excited. I can't wait. But, I will. Yeah. I will wait for your editor to have a baby.
I know.
So my thing now is like I've noticed in, especially well, again, my purview is mostly historical, and I just finished the last the most recent Louisa James. The name is funny. It's very much like a fall. The hero falls first and falls hard. And so that's my big thing. I love this new trope of hashtag falls first, falls hard. I love it. And that's what I loved about this book too, was like, he's like in it to win it. I mean, I think that's great. I think, I mean, cause we get so much about the heroine chasing after the hero. I'm like, you know what? It's nice to be chased every so often.
I feel like all of my books are.
Yes.
I like that though.
I do too.
Right. I don't want the girl like chasing after him.
I think in my last review, I said, how many of us in our lives have had girls say to us, I would just love to be chased for once.
Yeah.
That's exactly.
I literally texted to a friend of mine a couple weeks ago.
Yeah. I'd love to be chased. Yeah. And that's like, and that's where we're coming from. And I love that trope, and I think it's great. And I want it all over the.
Yeah, the, I agree.
Yeah.
Even like, especially as like a lady who has been married for I don't know how many years. I'm not going to lie to you. A lot of years. I've been with my husband for over a decade. Like we've not been married for that long, but we've been together for over a decade. Yeah. And so like. It sucks to not be chased anymore. You know what I mean?
I get what you mean.
That's hard. Like once you've been in a long-term relationship, like all of that beginning stuff is gone, and the beginning stuff is addictive as fuck.
It is. Like it's kind of sad to like think about it and be like, okay, I'm never going to have like that first
never
like,
gonna have that
moment
again.
And all that kind of stuff. Right.
Never going to have those like butterfly things again. I mean, and it's not, I'm not saying that like my marriage is boring or that like, I wish I weren't married. Like amazing. And I love him so much. Mm-hmm. It's just that like once that stuff inevitably goes away.
Yeah.
It's an everyday thing. You get butterflies every day and it's all of a sudden it's just the norm.
Like, like it does eventually go away. And once that fades, if there is no love there, the relationship is over. Like, because now it sucks. Now it's boring.
Yeah.
You know? So like, I completely understand that's just the evolution of a relationship, but that stuff is fun.
Yeah.
No. That's what makes you love someone. Yeah.
Side note, this is like kind of not related, kind of related. Cause you're talking about, that's just not fun. That's not what we want to read in a romance novel. Right. Mm-hmm. I once had one of my readers message me and be like, could you like not write a guy with like a normal sized dick and who's not good at sex? And I was like, absolutely not. And she was like going on about how she really wanted to read this because it's realistic. And I was like, no, like I was like, I'm sorry, you're not getting that from me. Like we write, like you read this to like escape.
Yes.
Right.
Like,
give
we talked about that a little bit.
Penis.
Yes, we talked about it.
Literally throwing you around the room.
Yes.
Like, yeah. We literally talked about that.
Yes, we did. In fact, we talked about it in part in the context of my tattoo because my husband drew it up for me and we realized that my arm is 9 inches long from my wrist to my elbow.
And before.
That was the first thing I immediately texted Ray, and I was like, "Hey, by the way, my forearm."
I'm gonna pull behind the curtains. I'm gonna pull behind the curtains, and we were talking about a certain porn star that both of us know, and we're like,
"Not personally, we don't like know him."
No, we know, we don't know. But we're like, "I bet you that's the same." And so at one point, we were on Zoom together and I'm looking him up and looking up videos. I'm like, I think his hands are like this. So I put
I was like, so now we're just on Zoom looking at porn.
We're just talking
like,
on the phone together.
This is what our relationship is now.
No, I mean, well, FYI, we've sent things to each other on the show. We're the worst. Anyhow,
we're just setting each other poor now. Cool. This is where we are. We've known each other a long time.
Yeah.
Okay. Anywho,
13 years exact. Yes. Thank you.
How many?
Is it 13? It's 13, right? No. It's 10 years.
No. It's more than that. It has to be. I'm 37.
Okay. We'll figure it out.
We'll figure it out later. This is irrelevant. Okay. So anyway, do you follow hockey? You're Canadian. I assume you do.
Yep.
Who is your team? Who is your player?
Okay. Like, I don't. So my cousin used to play for the Vancouver Canucks. So that was just like my team by, you know, had to be.
Default? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
He no longer plays. My husband's team is the Leafs, so I feel like I have to say that. He would be disappointed if I don't, but they suck. I was reading him the questions earlier today, and he was like, oh, well, that's an easy one. Leafs and Matthews. And I was like, no and no. But, you know, like, I'll say Leafs, but my favorite player, 100%, just because he's so hot, is Tom Wilson. Yes. And who's the other guy I really like?
I think you should probably look into the dude we sent you.
I think I'm going to. I think you should get his jersey. What's that?
Get his jersey. To torment your husband. That poor man.
Oh, I know. He hates the Habs. They're his. So that's what I should say. That should be on record.
Okay.
Is me saying my favorite team is the Habs. So when he listens to this, when it's posted, the Habs are my favorite team.
Okay. Yeah. There we go. On the record.
Yeah. Okay. He can probably hear me anyways.
He's probably in the next room, like silently screaming to himself. Whisper screaming.
He's in his group chat right now being like, you won't fucking believe what she just
fucking
said.
Believe what my wife is saying on this podcast. Tally mark. Have you watched any adaptations of Pride and Prejudice? And if so, which one's your favorite?
I've only watched the Keira Knightley one.
Oh, okay. That's fine.
Okay.
You win.
I was sharing these with like my writer friends, and they were like, oh, did they read The Fine Print by Lauren Asher? Because I guess the main guy in that book watches all of the adaptations of Pride and Prejudice because the female main character is obsessed with it or something. I was like, oh, maybe. No, you guys haven't read it, have you?
I haven't read it yet. It's on my list, though.
Because it would be me. Because I literally have...
Hang on. I think I have it on my Kindle. Like, I already
I was wondering if the main character was me, because I literally have every single copy of adaptation of Pride and Prejudice, because it was my favorite book growing up, like, ever. And then it was, like, right now there's a, like, the difference is about this, is between Pride and Prejudice and North and South by Elizabeth Gaskell. So it's like right there. Which I say is North and South with unions. Anyhow.
Yeah, that's true.
It's legit.
North and South is very good.
It's very good. So on this podcast, I fell in love with Colin Firth as Mr. Darcy from the 1995 Pride and Prejudice. However, I became a woman with the 2005 Pride and Prejudice.
Accurate. Which one is that?
It's the one with Keira, the one you watched, the one with Keira Knightley.
Okay.
And Matthew McFadden. Because
so then maybe I have watched the one with Colin Firth.
You would remember, because they allude to it in Bridgerton when Anthony falls into the pond or into the Serpentine, and he gets out. He's like, he takes his shirt off. That's supposed to be
he's wearing white.
He takes his jacket off.
Shirt
jacket
that is like totally soaked. That is a Colin Firth moment. That is absolutely a throwback to Colin Firth in Pride and Prejudice.
Yeah, because it's not obviously in the book. But
I mean, it's very good. It's just that it's like, it's a 6-part miniseries or something. It's just more historically accurate.
Accurate, but the whole like, there's so many like the hand where he goes
through, the hand flex in hand flex, the 2005 version.
He's going to go in to kiss her when it's like raining, and she's and she's angry at him. And it's like, gonna be angry kiss. It's like there's a whole lot of things. So we asked
2005 project. That's our favorite too. Kiss. Yep.
Oh, wet angry kiss. Thank you. Yeah. So that's we do ask everyone, like, what is your? It's not like it's not a. It's been so long
since I've seen it, to be honest with you.
We should all watch it again and just touch base again.
Let's have a watch party.
We should. We really should.
Yes.
Don't even throw it out there because we'll do it. And we will invite you and expect it to be on the calendar.
Legit, we've done two commentaries on we found a musical Pride and Prejudice,
and there is also the Mormon version,
which I hope.
Oh.
Yes,
I'm the one who told her about it. Yes.
Yep, I didn't even know it existed.
It's good. What's it's not bad. It's actually not bad.
No, it's not bad. Great. It's not, very early 2000s, late
90s. It is 2002. Yep.
And it's obvious.
Yeah, it's when you watch clothes it. I wore in college. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Like the reason most of us have eating disorders or like difficulty with like with healthy eating because of all
I looked at all these clothes. I'm like, I had that. Cool.
Low rise jeans.
Oh god.
They weren't good for any of us.
Yep. Halloween. What? So
anywho.
Next question.
So we've kind of covered like what you're working on now. Are you finishing Garrett's book still?
I've like completed the first draft of it in January, but now I'm kind of going through it a second time and fine tuning like some of the conflicts and that kind of stuff.
Awesome.
Have
you already started writing another one?
No. So I'm so back and forth between, I really wanted to start on Adams, but then I also wanted, my plan was to go back and forth between my baseball series and my hockey series, because I didn't want to, basically what happened with Love You Wild, I didn't want to get too far away from either one of the series and then feel like I didn't know the characters again and have a really difficult time getting back into one book. But I think I'm just going to focus on doing my rewrite of Garrett's book right now. And then I don't know. I can't decide if I want to go into Adam's book while it's fresh. I actually introduce a new guy in Garrett's book as well. So the series just kind of keeps going.
I love it.
There's nothing wrong with it.
I don't want this to end. I love this group of friends so much.
I do too. Spoiler alert. That was my bottom bun, was like it was the side characters, like specifically the guys, because their relationships with each other is just so funny. So funny. And I love how they rally around each other and they're so supportive of each other. Like when shit goes down with, that's only counting as one, you guys.
Dose.
When things go down with Courtney, like the way that everybody rallies around Adam. And then when things are like hitting the fan with Olivia and Carter, like they all they gather around Carter and they're just like, we want to help you, but like you have to tell us. Like, you just got to tell us what's going on.
They're such like a good group that like, I just feel like genuinely like loves each other so much. Like it's definitely got that like bit of found family, I think, in it, because I don't know, they're just so important to each other. And I loved like continuing on with that in Garrett's book. And it just got so much sweeter because obviously I've already said Garrett winds up with Carter's sister. So you've kind of like, I don't want to spoil things for you guys,
but
you've got that like typical, like kind of people finding out along the way, what's happening. Well, and poor Adam finds out and he's just like stressed out, like to the max, because he's like so worried, like genuinely for Garrett's health and well-being when, you know, Carter should eventually find out. But it's so sweet because there's so many heart to hearts between the guys. And like a lot of the feedback I got was that like people just loved how open the guys were with each other. Like that it was just a very like caring relationship. There's I love yous passed between them, like man hugs and stuff. And like I don't think realize that it wasn't very typical to see that side of guys, I guess, in books, right. But I enjoy writing it. So
I think it's important like that it's there. It.
Yeah.
You know, and Veronica and I actually, and I have had this conversation on the podcast before. We've talked about like this generation of men who are coming up that are more, you know, in tune with like women and just social issues and with one another, that it's not like we're getting it farther away from the toxic masculinity.
Yes,
so this is like, I think it's perfect. Like this group of 27-year-olds would be like, yes, it makes complete sense that they were like, they're more, hey, we're friends. We're together. We, you know, we can say, I love you. And it's not, you know, gay. It's like,
right. Yeah.
No, I love you, dude. It's I think there's something good. There's something good about that. I do think that we're turning a corner on what our young people. I have no fear about our young people who are growing up anymore. Well,
that's good, because I mean, they're like, I'm just like turning it back to like stigma surrounding like mental health with men, particularly, right? Yeah. So I think it's nice to see that they're allowed to have emotions and show them and stuff, right? Rather than
keeping, I think it's important. In. Yes.
Right.
Absolutely. Right. Exactly. We have to like normalize that. I mean,
yeah.
Right.
I think we gotta
move forward instead of moving like 5 steps backward. Yep.
Yeah.
I mean, like, it's funny, like, again, the person who likes historical romance is the one who's like, I love all this fucking shit going on closer to
That's two.
I got it.
That's two.
Okay. To our, you know, we're moving closer to like where we should be as a culture and a person, you know, and you guys in Canada have it different. In America, it's toxic. It's real toxic, way more than you guys have. Like,
or at least that's our perception. I mean, I don't know. We don't live in Canada. Although I do try to convince my husband to move there at least once a week.
I mean, you guys didn't have a sweet convoy.
That's what I was just going to say. We're normally pretty good, but we just had this.
Oh, no, it came to D.C. Thank you. We know all about it.
Don't worry.
Thank you for that.
Mm-hmm. Well, it turned into like something just awful. I was like, this is so... I don't even want to like...
It came from the U.S. We're sorry.
It came from us and went to you. Don't worry about it. There's a piece of shit here. I'm going to take
it. Goes.
There's a piece of shit here in the United States I'll take all of them. There's a piece of shit here in the United States who has started this whole thing with the content. Yeah. So no worries.
Well,
yeah.
We talk about him a lot.
Not on the podcast, but between
me. No, a little breaky for me.
A little breaky.
Yeah. Well, we can talk about it off air. We can.
Yeah.
Yep.
Well, I have a question I want to ask Becca once we're done. So, okay. All right. So we can wrap up by asking what inspires you. You've talked about how you like to hike with the dog.
I don't particularly for like a story. Anything comes out of nowhere with me, to be honest. Like, I might just have like an idea for like a conflict that I really want to see go down, or like a chase that I really want to see happen, or a meet cute that I really want to see. That's how I started writing my baseball romance, because I was like, I just really want to see like a baseball superstar crash into a girl in the stands. That's how they meet.
I love that. I'm excited about it. Yeah.
Uh-huh. You're gonna get Ray into baseball romance. It's gonna be amazing. Uh-huh. I'm already into baseball romance.
Thank you.
I don't care what the sport is in a romance. I just want him to be an athlete. That's all that matters.
Yeah. That way. He's strong as hell.
Exactly.
I mean,
yeah. It means they're tall most of the time, muscular.
Yeah.
Most of the time, fairly arrogant, or at least some sort of alpha.
Okay.
Sets up enemies to lovers.
Guess what you're describing? You're describing a rake. Thank you.
Yes.
A what? You're
describing a reformed rake. That's one of our favorite. A rake is like the historical romance version of like a man whore.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay.
Anthony Bridgerton.
Capital R, rake. Yeah. Thank you.
Capital R. Rake with a capital R. I'm sorry. We kind of interrupted you there.
That's okay.
But I really like that I want to read that baseball book, and I will wait as patiently for it as I can.
It's a tearjerker, though, because I'm going to be honest. So this kind of ties into more inspiration, but if you read my acknowledgments, I started writing because I had such like severe anxiety because my older brother had passed away unexpectedly. And I was just kind of like, I need to work through this. I need to do something. And it was like 2 years later almost. So a lot of like my inspiration just comes from, you know, their life is too short. And so the baseball book where it's like all light and fluffy on the surface, like very much like Consider Me, except the main man is not a Carter. He's not like a very arrogant type of guy, yeah. But he's amazing. He's such a great hero. And the girl is very like goofy and like carefree, but it revolves around like her grief journey because she's lost her brother. Mm. And it's a tearjerker because she works with sick children as well. So
Ray's going to cry the whole time, but I'm also going to love it. I'll probably also cry.
Like, I'm not going to lie. Again, I shared the first draft of this one on Wattpad the other year, and people, I don't think I've had a single person say they've gotten through that book without weeping.
Get it.
So, yeah.
I love you, Becca, but I'm going to cry. Thank you. I love you, Becca, but I hate you right now. I'm going to read it and I'm going to cry and I'm going to be like,
yeah. It's like Emily Henry, though. Like, you, I sobbed reading Beach Read. Sobbed. But like,
oh, I did too.
Oh, you should read Beach Read from Emily Henry.
If you like that angsty stuff, man.
Yeah, if you like the angsty stuff.
I do. I really like to cry. So
also, I have...
Girl, we need to have a conversation. Why? What is happening?
I just need to be happy at the end.
That's true.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, so I will say this about Beach Read. A very particular point hit me hard. However, I also really love books about writers because I'm a writer. So like, yeah. it's a book about two writers. One is a romance writer. One is like a literary fiction writer, you know,
what's the one guy that he brought up and he was like, no, I'm not that guy. What the hell's his name?
I don't remember.
When
do we read that?
God, Jonathan
Swift.
What?
Okay. I don't know what you're talking about.
Keep going.
I don't know. Look it up.
Okay. I'm looking it up.
Okay. So anyway, we were like, we're going to read this book called Beach Read at the end of the summer. It'll be a nice lighthearted thing that wraps up our summer. And how we wrapped up our summer was me just sobbing like a fucking child. Tally ho. Because
Jonathan Franzen.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Highly recommend Beach Read from Emily Henry. And if you cry when you're reading it
down.
And you're upset about it, you can also just blame Emma Jackson because she's...
Well, does it have a good ending? A happy ending for the couple, because I can't otherwise.
It does. Okay. However, I will also say... Oh, God. Sorry. There's a UK version that is a different ending. And the UK ending is better.
I'm going to say, though, the crying part had nothing to do with the couple, though.
No, that's the crying part didn't really have a lot to do with
the couple.
No,
my
it does not.
Okay. No, yeah, it's related to her and the journey that she is on.
Yeah. I like that.
I think you'll like that book.
Yeah. Go on.
No, we've kept you longer than we promised we would keep you. And I feel terrible about it.
It's going on 2 hours. I feel so awful.
I feel terrible about it.
I've had fun, so.
Thank God. Okay.
Because,
excellent to hear that. So if you have anything else you would like to tell us or our audience or anything like that.
You want to plug some stuff?
Plug anything?
I don't know how to plug myself.
Tally ho.
I'm still learning how to do it on TikTok.
Yeah, it's difficult.
I don't know.
TikTok is like an enigma. Don't worry about it. It's fine.
Gen Z runs it.
Yeah, it's gonna be like some 16-year-old.
It's how you get like your books out there now, though.
I mean, it helps.
I learned how to TikTok.
I like that that's a verb. I have to learn how to TikTok now.
Yeah.
Well, we can happily recommend Love You Wild and Considering.
Absolutely. Yep.
100%. Thank you.
We are eagerly awaiting the next ones. No matter what, whether it's Garrett or baseball or whatever.
And we'd like to have you back when we do read that.
Yeah.
If you were I would love to listen.
Yeah. If we come back.
I will tell you.
Yeah.
My books, I feel like, are getting progressively smuttier. So the baseball one is smutty. Play With Me.
How sad.
So Garrett and Jenny's story is the smuttiest book I have ever written.
All you're doing is making me want to smash that one click button. Like, just.
It's very smutty. It's very good.
For it. We're both here for it.
There's nothing wrong with that. We're fine with it. Completely fine.
No.
Yeah.
No. Mm-hmm. I brought up the whole come and her and ripping out twice on the episode. Uh-huh. It's fine. Don't worry about it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we talked about that last night. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Okay. I'm gonna listen to that.
Perfect. Can't wait. We are a mess. Anyway, thank you so much, Becka Mack, for your time.
Thank you for
having such a wonderful discussion with us. Basically, you just made us love you more. So
I
guess there's that.
I'm very happy to be here. This was a lot of fun.
Oh, great. Well,
thank God.
I just wish I had brought my wine.
Damn it. Next time, girl.
Next time. Tally mark.
Yeah, now I know for next time.
Tally ho.
We're back,
bitches. Damn it.
There it is.
Mm-hmm.
For those counting at home, at least in our real-time tally, I currently have 13. What are you up to? 16, 17 now?
Yep. 17. Yep.
Okay. All right.
I might as well just go, just keep swearing and make it a whole nice round 50.
We might catch some.
I do have to say, I have a little tangent real quick. So there's a college around Cleveland, Malone College. Shout out, I guess. I don't know. But
shout out? Question mark?
It's a very religious college. It's a very conservative college. And so in the dorms, you can't swear. Like, it is like a swear jar. And this was many years ago, so I don't know if it's the same. It could have changed. My cousin, his girlfriend was going to school there. And I don't really understand why she went there, because she doesn't seem like she'd be the type that'd be, like, into that. But it's fine. But my cousin was not, like, he would swear, yeah. So he'd show up there, and he would just give the RA, he'd be like, here's $20 for the weekend. He's like, here you go.
I'm just not going to bother.
Yeah.
Here's some money.
Yep. Here you go.
Who polices that? Like,
I don't know.
That's a dumb rule. How are you supposed to police that? Also, they're adults.
Well, that was the school that I started filling the application at, and I got to, there was no, like, social dancing. And I'm like, I'm sorry.
And this is the town from Footloose. We're done here.
Right. Pretty much. I was like, okay. And, like, you couldn't play cards. I'm like,
Remember we used to work with someone who refused to celebrate Halloween?
You have to tell me off air because I can't remember who it was.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll talk about it.
Yeah.
It was for those reasons.
I'm rolling my eyes so hard because Halloween is one of my favorite holidays. Anyhow.
Yeah. Of course.
Yep. I mean, got a horror podcast.
Yep.
Oh, I just found out tonight.
It's called Booze, Boobs, and Blood, you guys. You should listen to it.
I sent a message to Ween tonight because I was looking through. I was like, I wonder if there's any Easter haunted, you know, horror haunted attractions or whatever.
Other than, like, Donnie Darko.
You need to go through a plane crash. Yes. No. Okay. But Hudson had a fucking St. Patrick's Day one. And I was so pissed. I was like, oh, good God.
Really?
Yes.
Huh. Interesting.
I hit all the 4th of July. I want all the fucking holidays.
You gonna collect them all?
Yep. Uncle Sam.
You need to have, like, a punch card.
Yeah. And, like, I'll Uber to everyone so I can get drunk as possible at each one of them. Perfect.
There you go.
Yep.
There you go.
Anywho, let's.
Anywho, shall we talk about stars and bars?
I wish I were a Dixie. Yes. Eggplants and hearts. Ridiculous.
Eggplants and hearts. For people who are new to the show, A, welcome. B, it's just a joke because sometimes Ray accidentally says stars and bars instead of hearts and eggplants. Like, I don't know why. I think it's just musical theater. Like, it just comes out. I don't know what it is.
Because I usually
we're make... from Ohio. Like, we do not fly a Confederate flag.
No, we make fun of like people ever. Who do. Yeah.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Especially around here where I was like, you know, we were on Union side, right?
We were on the Union side.
We were
side,
on the winning side. We were on the winning team.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Assholes.
Damn it.
You know what? I'm going to take that one. I'm going to take it.
That was worth it. That's what she said.
Worth it. All right. So let's do first. Let's do hearts first. Give me some hearts.
Okay.
Give me some warm heart cockles. What?
Okay. The cockles are you hot.
Cackles.
Okay. Okay. You did snort. It was adorable. I almost said the F word, but I did not. It's like the first time I've ever censored myself.
Oh my gosh.
I know. I don't know why. It's for charity, right? I'm sure they will be really grateful for our $50 donation.
Like, what the frick do I do with this?
Is it too late to get a match?
Write in if you'd like to match our donation. Write in
if you'd like to.
I am now up to $20, guys. $20 going once, going twice.
Write in if you would like to match our swearing donations.
We just don't know where we're going to donate it right now. Could be a cloud retirement home. We don't know. Also, I would love to go to a clown. No, I don't. I would burn it down to the ground because I hate clowns.
No,
anyhow,
I hate clowns. Gosh, no, they're always creepy. They're never okay.
No, they've never been funny. Guess what's never been funny? Clowns.
A clown. Nope. Never one time.
Nope.
Not one time in the history of the world.
The only time it was funny is when it got hit in the face with something. Pie, a shoe,
I guess.
A bat. Anyhow,
something heavy.
Yep.
Okay, so hearts. All right. This is tough for me because... So Carter buys like a lot of gifts.
Yeah.
For Olivia. He likes to spoil her. He has a stupid amount of money. He's like one of the highest paid players in the league. Mm-hmm. But the gift buying is not really a matter of romance to me.
No.
It's the way that he shows her he loves her even before he tells her he loves her. Mm-hmm. And the things that he does for her, like the one thing that he buys her in particular is so, so fucking romantic. I'll take that one. Because he does it because he knows that she needs it.
Right.
Like it's a very practical thing that he does for her.
It's a health situation, actually.
It's a health situation. Like he does it. It's just so sweet when he does it. And he doesn't think twice about it. He's just like, "What?"
As soon as it happened, I knew what was going to happen.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
Yes, same. Yeah. So, like, there's some foreshadowing there. I think you can probably guess. Like, when it starts to come up, you're like, you'll probably know. So I feel like... And the things that he says to her are just so sweet. And, like, the way that they are together is very sweet.
Yeah.
Even if like his brand of showing her how he feels is not something that I would enjoy or that like it embarrasses the hell out of her.
Yeah, I kind of love that. I kind of love that like he's all in and he's like, I want to show everybody that I am all in.
He is not ashamed whatsoever and is like, he's over the top about everything he does. Everything.
And I think it's like, I think he realized, and I could be wrong. We could ask Becca. But it's every time she says that she's like, every time there's an article that says she's not enough, he does something bigger and he does something that's more like, I am her boyfriend. I am hers. Mm-hmm. I'm off limits. Like they at one point talk about how he's like, he goes to like, if a woman starts coming over to me, just puts his arms in the air.
He just like puts his arms in the air. Just like, I am not touching her.
Yeah.
At one point, he has a shirt that says, I love my GF. Yep. Like, in the I love New York style shirt. Yeah. I heart my GF or whatever it is.
Yeah.
And then buys her a matching one.
Yeah. I think part of it is silly, but part of it, I think, is, like, he knows he needs to do that to make sure that everyone knows that she is enough.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So in that regard, I didn't really answer the question yet.
You did not.
I said 3.5 to 4.
I'm going to co-sign.
Okay. Yeah. Fair enough. Yeah.
So
hit me in the face with some eggplants.
Exactly. Thank you very much. Do you want me to go?
Yes, please.
4. I mean,
are you going to hit me in the face? Okay. Yeah.
I'm going to hit you with 4.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, there's no question.
Like, we need a sound effect of, like,
I was going over.
Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. No one else can see what I can see. This is good podcasting material.
Oh. I have my eyes are watering so much today. I don't think I've laughed a lot today. Anyhow.
Hi, Mr. Veronica. I can hear him. okay, so cosine on the 4, like, borderline 4.5, like, it's of, like, the sheer volume, like, the number of sex scenes.
Oh, I mean, it's
a lot of them.
A lot. I mean, almost every chapter there's something.
Yeah. There's a, I mean, it's frequent.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not, and it's, they're explicit, but they're not, like, erotica explicit.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't classify it like that. It's just that it's frequent and hot.
Yeah, the first time is pretty explicit.
Yes.
Everybody says he's gonna, like, come at her so much that it's gonna be dripping down her leg for the rest of the afternoon.
For the next 24 hours.
Yeah. I was like, okay.
I was like, oh my.
That's vivid. Yes, I got that.
Very vivid.
Yeah. I could see that. But yeah,
Lord.
Yeah. I mean, it wasn't to the point where I thought it was, like, too much. But it was hot. They were all hot. They were really hot.
Oh, yeah.
Guys. Mm-hmm. These are very steamy. The
mm-hmm.
spicy meatball. Yep.
Side note related, since we're getting tattoos tomorrow, I want my tattoo to be is my forearm, and so I asked my husband you know I'm gonna tell Becca this tomorrow
yes,
I asked my
yeah,
husband
yeah,
yeah, to
yeah, yeah, yeah.
To draw my tattoo.
And I'm gonna look up. I'm gonna look up the quote. I'm gonna look up the quote from the book.
Okay. Yes. Please do it. So I asked my husband last night, like, can you draw my tattoo, please? Because, like, we want to try and get him on Saturday. And he's like, okay, roll up your sleeve. Like, so he gets out the measuring tape and measures my forearm, and from my elbow to my wrist, it's apparently about 9 inches, and I immediately texted Ray and said, so my forearm is the size of Carter's dick, because I was giggling like a teenage boy. And he looks at me and he's like, what is the matter? Like, what are you laughing at? And so I finally told him the book that we are reading, that we're recording about this weekend, my forearm is the length of his dick.
And I'm trying to find, oh my God, why can't I
find
Did you search
for the number 9?
No, I searched for stomach, because she says she can.
Oh, I think he says throat a few times. You're going to feel it in my, yeah. Oh, I think I found it. Hang on. The energy in the room is electrically charged, is about as electrically charged as the 9 inches of titanium straining behind my zipper. Yep.
I'm looking to see. There's a part, though, they're having sex and she literally says, I almost can feel it in my stomach.
Good Lord.
I swear. Maybe I'm mad. Maybe it's tummy or something like that, but I'm like, I'm not finding it. I thought it was early on.
I swear I had a goddamn epiphany last night while my sword of thunder was buried 9 inches deep inside the most insanely stunning woman I have ever sparred with.
Yeah, I can't find,
because I'm up to 15, folks.
I'm gonna. No, I can't find it. Dang it! I should have highlighted it while I went through it. Maybe I did. I don't think I did, though. Yeah, so four, for sure. I mean, like, I love that both of us are like, yep, that's one. Yep, four. Okie dokie. So then we're going to move on to stunt casting.
Oh, yes. All right. So earlier today, Ray sent me an article just of hockey players. Hot hockey players
from something.
I would like you to go first.
We would want to do the girls first?
Sure.
Okay, let's do the ladies first. Ladies, all the ladies. No?
Ladies first.
So I was looking for someone who's around 25 and fair. Short. So
yep. Short is the main qualifier.
Huh. And so I believe I found said person. She's adorable too. I know her from one show, not the other.
Winnie, you're okay. I know.
She is 5'1", so we're...
Oh, why does she... Oh! Okay, got it.
It's Kiernan Shipka from Mad Men and Sabrina.
Yep.
And
I've not seen either of those shows, but I do know of the show Sabrina.
Yeah, I mean, that one picture, her eyes are just like... I can't stop looking at them.
Yes.
She's very, very pretty.
She's beautiful.
Supposedly at one point, possibly dating Timothy Chalamet.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And like, there's a picture. Well, I don't know. And then if you look up who's Timothy Chalamet dating? It's like, not her. I don't know. Whatever. It's Hollywood. But right. There's one where he's like hugging her. And it says, I'm going, again, this is IMDb saying he's 5'10". I'm like, he's not 5'10". And she looks a lot shorter than him. But I'm like, so I bet you he's about 5'8", and so she's 5'1", seems probably right.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, she's a small person.
She's tiny.
Yeah.
But she's 22, so we're close enough, right?
Yeah, close enough.
Yep.
I did not pay attention to age, because you know how Hollywood rolls.
Right.
And also, the actress that I chose, I think she could play a wide variety of ages.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe I've used her before for different things, but I don't care. It's my podcast.
Do what I want to.
I do what I want.
Mm-hmm.
All right, here. You'll know immediately.
I wonder, because I went in and I was like, oh, I see this picture a lot. So I was like, I wonder if she picked her. Okay.
Yep. So I picked Anna Kendrick because she is super tiny and has brown hair that mm-hmm. can also be wavy
mm-hmm.
when requested.
She
also, the other thing that I really liked about Anna Kendrick in particular is that she can do snark very well.
She can.
And at one point, in fact, this is one of my very favorite parts of, hang on. This is one of my favorite parts. Something happens where they are photographed together.
Mm-hmm.
And they're not, like, doing anything particularly obscene, but, they're like, they're making out, right. You know? And so she teaches high school students. So clearly, like, the high school boys are, like, getting on her back. And people are, like, teachers are looking at her in the hallway, like, making comments.
Yeah.
That are kind of suggestive. Inappropriate, definitely.
Yeah. For your work, especially for your colleague. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Rude. Mm-hmm. Dickhead. I'll take that one happily.
Yeah.
So she is in class with a bunch of 17-year-old boys.
Yeah.
Who are telling her about these pictures and this article that has been written. And it's the one that is saying that she is not enough for him, or asking if she will be enough for him.
Yeah.
So she's not really, like, she's looking at the picture and then is like, oh no, but then is reading the article and it's the article that's getting to her.
Yeah.
But regardless, the teenage boy commentary is going on.
Right.
In the meantime. And one student, I forget who. It's Brad. Starts and says, I didn't take you for a puck bun. Don't you dare. I growl, reeling on Brad. He backs himself up against a wall, shaky hands in the air as I step into him. An entire foot taller than me, and this boy is scared of me right now. Finish that sentence and see what happens, Brad. I dare you. I may be small, but I will put you in the ground and bury you 6 feet deep. Nobody yes. will find you, Brad. Nobody. And I absolutely, when I was thinking about actresses, I was like, I need someone who can deliver that line.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, really forcefully and in a terrifying way. Yeah. And I was like, Anna Kendrick is my lady.
There you go. And that comes back later, too. Which one was the one?
Oh, it does.
Yeah.
It does. In a way that made me laugh out loud and also cheer.
Yeah.
Yep.
Holler. Mm-hmm. Oh, let's move to the man of the moment.
Let's discuss Carter, shall we?
Oh... Guys, it could have been anybody on this list. Honestly, it could have been.
Absolutely could have been.
I almost swore. It could have been anybody. But I chose this gentleman. I'm trying to find one of these ones that has his name on it.
That has his name on it. That first one.
It doesn't? Okay. Okay, I gotta go back to it. Because I've got five pictures here. Because I couldn't decide. Because I was like, yes, I have five. Because they're all great. They're all great pictures.
All great.
This last one is him in a gay pride jersey. So I am here for it.
Please. Oops.
And I'll have to go back to that first one because I don't remember what his name is.
it's Roman Josie, I think.
Yeah. He is Scandinavian or something. He is I just wrote the F word to her earlier, and I was like, this guy, I can't. His eyes and his face, he's very good looking. Yes. I mean, no dimples, unfortunately. Lily Carter's got dimples, but.
Yeah.
I mean, I can see, especially that first one. Yep. And he's got green eyes, too, so.
He does. He's very, very pretty.
He's very pretty. Yeah, because Carter's got green eyes. I mean, I only remember that because she says it a number of times. He has emerald colored eyes.
Emerald eyes. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, oh. If you guys don't follow our Pinterest, you really should.
You really should. Yeah. We have spank naughty lists, but then we also have our stunt casting. All of our stunt casting.
We also have a folder of just random hot people.
Just random hot people. Mm-hmm. I think my kid got out of bed. Whoops. Okay, so
I'm ready.
Earlier, you and I were joking about perhaps we chose the same person.
We did, didn't we?
For the first time in the history of this podcast.
Yes.
We chose the same fucking person.
I knew.
Oh, damn it.
I got down to him and I was like, for one, he's perfect.
Yep.
And two, like, there's just no way. There's no way that there's any... Yep, that was the one. The hockey fights cancer one. I was like, oh, yep. There's a picture with him and a bunch of kids, too. And I was like, oh. My ovaries exploded.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Ovaries have been obliterated.
Yep.
But yeah, we chose the same guy. Person. And actually one of the same pictures. So the one of him in the purple tie, the closer one, not the one with him with like the hockey stick, mm-hmm. but like, the headshot looking one.
I just need to sit and look at him for a little longer. I mean, he's that one with him just with the kit on.
Yeah. I know.
Like, he's too... It's like, it hurts to look at him. He's so hot.
He's very pretty.
Like...
But, like, also just super hot. Like, how?
I mean, I would literally take that picture of him in that gay pride jersey and use it as background on my phone.
Which one is the gay pride jersey?
I see it.
Got it. Mm-hmm. Yes. Very hot. Yeah. Oh, jeez.
Okay. Yeah. Isn't he like Canadian? Or not Canadian. He's like Swedish or something.
Wait, is this him with a dog?
Oh, gosh. God
damn it.
You don't want my...
There you go.
Great. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Oh, God. Okay. Get under those sweatpants. Oh, my God. It's perfect, too. It's perfect. Oh.
I know.
Oh, my God. I know. It's so... Okay, we need to talk to Becca about this tomorrow. Because I have a feeling this kid, this has to be the same. This has to be her inspiration.
I'm going to put it in the document. I'm going to link to it.
And then we're going to screen share.
We'll just show her our Pinterest.
Be like, is this the gentleman that you were thinking of when you wrote this? Okay. So one last thing that we do before we move on to our what we're reading and stuff is, would you recommend this book?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I would.
Yeah. 100% from me. What's the other one we say?
Would this book embarrass our moms?
Yes.
Yes, it would. Yes. No question. This book would embarrass the living hell out of our moms.
So my mom has been in the hospital and I went to see her yesterday and she's reading The Sweet Spot. So I bought The Sweet Spot and gave it to her. And so she's reading that in the hospital. So
oh, that's very sweet.
She said she likes it so far. So.
Ooh, you know what? I should bring you tomorrow. Writing this on my hand. Actually, I will set a reminder in my phone because then it'll keep reminding me. Okay. Hold, please, everyone, while I force myself to remember. Making a note. Ray's Christmas present.
I will sit again. Okay.
And also the Lucy Monroe books.
Mm-hmm.
For Mama Ray.
Mm-hmm.
Was there any others?
Do you have the
Adulting?
No, I don't think. I don't know if she'll like that one.
Okay.
There was another one. Which one was it that you had and I didn't? I don't remember. Oh, okay. If I think of it, I'll ask you for it.
Okay. Okay, yeah. So what are you reading right now, darling?
So I'm only just going to touch on the one really quick and just say, please go to our website. And I just wrote a review for Eloisa James's How to Be a Wallflower. I loved it. I actually was texting with Veronica and being like, This is so sex positive. It's crazy. It's the first her historical romance I've read where the heroine is a virgin, but like pretty... verse on what happens and has actually seen her mom took her to a brothel.
Yeah, you were telling yeah. Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah,
and
you were
actually gifted her with condoms. So yep. She had condoms. Yep. And so I thought it was like it was so refreshing that it was like, you know, she still was kind of like it's a big thing for her. And she wasn't like, you know, just sleeping with everybody, which is fine. There's not a big, you know, I don't know, but it's tough that to like look at that and suspend your disbelief for that period. But this part of this, it was like, I think it actually was very, to me, not related, but I could see it. It would be something I wasn't far from. I could see like, especially cause it all deals with a theater. So I can totally see it. So anyhow, go read my review. What I'm reading currently and I'm enjoying, I read the first one I wrote a review was, this one I'm reading is Sense and Second Degree Murder by Tirza Price. I read...
Oh, yeah. You read the first one.
Yeah. Pride and Premeditation. Yeah. So this one... And they're standalones, but they're like reimaginings of Jane Austen.
Love it.
So this one is really cute. And I wonder how far... like his Sense and Sensibility, I don't know how you feel about this one, is a tough one for me. I like it. But at the same time, there's so many despicable characters that it's like I want to punch everybody.
I'm not sure I've read Sense and Sensibility. If I did, it was in high school and I was not paying very close attention.
It's not one of my favorites, although I actually really like the I joke because I love the Emma Thompson version, the one where she's like ugly crying at the end of it, where Hugh Grant comes as Edward Ferris. But so this one's, I mean, Eleanor and Marianne are very into STEM. So Marianne was supposed to take over her dad's. It's super sad too, because part of it, like the first, you know, like two pages, whatever, their dad dies. Like they come in, Eleanor comes in, and that's the whole thing, is they think someone murdered him. So they're trying to solve his murder. But they have a detective agency. Like, her dad was a detective. Like, and so she was hoping to take over, like, the younger sister, like, the middle sister was wanted to take over. So that's where the whole, like, general, like, Sense and Sensibility, like, plot line goes. Because, you know, Edward comes in, or sorry, not Edward, but their brother, half-brother, although I think it's a cousin in the book. I don't know. It's been a long time since I've read it. Anyhow, and they're kind of, like, penniless. Because they couldn't inherit, because women couldn't inherit at that time.
Right, right.
So, anyhow, it's good. I'm enjoying so far. And I like the first one, so I'm sure I'll like this one.
Sure, yeah. I remember you, like, really enjoying that first book.
And it's not, excuse me, so just a disclaimer, so sorry, it's not our usual fare because it is young adult. But because it's Pride and Prejudice, of course, and that in Jane Austen, of course, I felt like I needed to read it.
Well, yeah, of course. Right. Hello.
Yeah.
Okay. So I actually took a break from this book because I knew I needed to get started on Consider Me so that I could get it done in time. But last week I started reading Staying Selfless by Liz Tomford. And she's another Cherry author, which is actually how we initially found Becka Mack through Cherry Publishing. So I must have recommended Becoming Selfish, which would have been was the first book in this series. And I think it's only a two-book series. So this one is a continuation. And
how many pages is this one?
Also, like, 600. It's, like, longer than the first one. And that was, like, by maybe 20 or 30 pages. I'm not sure. But that was, like, my chief complaint about the first book, was that it was too long. Also, 600-plus pages. I don't know. I'm not far enough along to know, like, what will be my meat for this one. Mm-hmm. But... thus far, enjoying it. Let me see how far I am. The first book leaves off with, like, a bit of a cliffhanger, because what happens is that some things really come to a head at the end of the book, where the heroine is, like, whose name is Logan, by the way, and nice. I just love, like, yes, exactly. I had to stop kind of early. I'm only about 16% of the way through. The heroine's name is Logan, and she, prior to the first book starting, had gone through, like, a major traumatic event and has really been putting off dealing with her trauma regarding that event. But at the end of the first book, it's been like a 3 or 4 month period of time. It's the end of the first semester of her master's degree. And it's like, it's new adult, like they're 23. And she just has like a fucking breakdown. Damn it. Oh, okay.
Sorry.
So I'm up to 20, you guys. So she really just has a breakdown, like, at the end of the book. And, we open back up with the two of them just in, like, a really uncertain place. And so we're back to, like, a better place with them already. But they're at different places in their lives. Like, she is a quarter of the way through a master's degree. And he is a fifth year senior hockey player. Because I guess that's all I'm doing is reading 600 page hockey romances right now.
You know, but as you do.
One does. So at any rate, she He is like about to be drafted. He's visiting with teams and is like getting, this is his last chance to be drafted into the NHL. So he's going to go wherever they will take him, you know? Mm-hmm. And so they are undoubtedly going to be separated. So the tension in this book is definitely going to be the fact that he is going to move and we just don't know where yet.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anywho, that's what I've been reading. And I have, as far as listening, I'm just catching up with Knowledge Fight because I haven't been listening. So,
oh, they have a really good, these last two episodes are fantastic.
I was just listening to the 22nd earlier today.
Oh, okay. So the last two are...
I have not listened to the last couple that you had texted me about earlier.
Yeah, there are depositions.
Yeah.
So I have, is a Confronting podcast. I started listening to this. It's pretty great. The second season, in particular, that's what I'm recommending, is Confronting Columbine. And so it's a deep dive into Columbine, how it changed the nation, how we look at not just gun control, but like safety in schools and mass shootings. And some of these people that they interview are survivors and people who knew the shooters. And it's, sorry to be a downer, but yeah, it's a rough listen. It is a rough listen, but I think in the world we live in, it's a must listen.
Well, you and I have talked in the past about how it's important to at least be informed about what's going on and to understand in depth about ways that we could help make the world a better place, safer place. I mean, you know, whatever, for the generation that comes after us.
And signs.
I mean, you know, from my advocacy work, like I deal with this all the time. Yeah. So,
and I think it's to look for signs too. I think it's also.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we need to understand what's going on. Otherwise, how are we supposed to fix it? I mean,
right.
We have to know. Right. How old were you? So I was in eighth grade when Columbine happened.
It was my freshman year of college.
Okay. Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I was actually in my dorm room that day. It was, I just remember going.
Those boys were like in between our age. Yeah. Like I was about to start high school and you were like in college. So like they were all sandwiched. Like all of those students were sandwiched between me and you.
And there is a really good book I have listened to. It's fantastic. I'm trying to find the name of it right now. I'm the worst because I can't. I think it's, is it the
not
one?
The worst.
Columbine, Dave Cullen. I think it's the one. Yeah, it's Dave. It's Columbine by David Cullen. It's talk about a rough. It's a rough listen. It's
yeah.
It's
was that 1999?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and I think what's sad is that like some of this could have been prevented. I think a lot of it
23 years.
Yeah, I mean a lot of it could have been prevented because I think some of the warning signs were there and no one saw them. But I don't want to ever say that because I shouldn't say that because I know in particular one of the moms. I cannot think of their names right now because I don't really, they don't live in my headspace. I try not to let them live in my headspace. But one of the moms is like an advocate for like gun control and how wrecked she is about this, so I would never want to say that like this is her fault. It's not. Like this was, I think there a lot of people could have seen the signs, not just families. I think a lot of like teachers and people in schools and other friends could have seen the signs. So, but now we know, and that's unfortunately that's now we know, and we do now we now see the signs, and we can.
That is a major part of it. And actually one study that has been done, a massive study that has been done, they found that in almost every single case there were warning signs.
Yeah,
almost every single one of them. You can do your part. This is not a political discussion. This is not about, I don't say this from like a shaming standpoint. I say it from a safety standpoint. If you have weapons in your house, please learn how to securely store them. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of, accidents happen with kids who find weapons. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, with school shootings, a lot of the times those weapons are found at home or in the home of a grandparent or something like that. So if you secure your weapons securely, if you store your weapons securely, you may be, you're helping to prevent violence at school. Yeah. So
100%.
Yeah.
Okay. What's coming up, my
this
dear?
This was a downer.
I'm
all right.
I'm so sorry. Hey.
It's okay. It's important. It's really, really fucking important. Damn it.
Why don't you listen to Absolute History and learn about how the sewer systems in Victorian London.
That is a disgusting story.
I need to send you that video. It's really fascinating. There's like a whole bunch of, there's like, it's not just one. There's like two or three videos because it's like, it's such a big thing that happened. I mean, it's such a.
You know I love history.
Oh, I know. I mean, I have a minor in it. I mean, I love it. Yes. But like, it is like, it's gross, but at the same time, it's what I like. Okay. I'm going to throw another thing in there to listen to. It's video. So, I mean, that's why I didn't choose it, because it is a video and it's on YouTube, but Absolute History is amazing. And one of their series is on Victorian, like it's everything about the Victorian era, like diseases and da 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 da, like how the, you know, the cotton trade changed the, you know, how women, you know, the clothing of Victorian England. But how the sewer system in freaking England in Victorian times, it literally saved millions of lives, and how, like, because people were dying from cholera, and I mean literally, like, people were just, it was like, if you fell, I think we brought this up in the Bridgerton episode, you fell in the fucking,
he fell in the Serpentine,
if you fall in the Thames, you're probably dead. I'm just gonna say, you probably have something,
so many diseases,
E. coli at least. Yeah, so it's very good.
Lots absolute of poop
history.
Diseases.
Yeah, absolute history. And there's this cute guy. His name's Tom Sullivan, I think, and Tom Robinson, who's called Walking with History. And he goes and he'll pick. And so what I was going to say about these shows is, like, there'll be the headline, like, man, a Russian immigrant lives in tree. And you're like, okay. What? And so he'll start, like, for this one in particular, like, he'll start the story about he was going to someplace in Australia. I can't remember what the city who's living in, who's going to Australia. In one of the stories that he started with was about these Russian immigrants who lived in a tree. They lived in, like, this, how the tree came down. It was like, it was a like almost like a cave. And but then it went into all kinds of other things that happened within this town historically. And so he's like kind of walking with history. And the same thing,
I like that.
And with this absolute history, there's also another one that's like Victorian pharmacy. So there's like these three people who actually work in, and they recreate what it was like to work in a Victorian pharmacy. I think I was texting the one day, I was like, no, it was my mom. I said, I'm literally watching someone make condoms. Cool.
Oh, I think you did talk to me about that.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, she was taking literally sheep's intestines and making, yeah. Yes, because we were talking about how we used to wash them because they were so expensive. So, like, the nobles, anybody who could afford them usually would just wash them. And honestly, they were probably more durable because they were, like, intestines. They weren't, like, although probably not as,
sanitary?
Well, no, not so much that, as they weren't some, yes, but no, actually, like, the sterilization process to make them was, I mean, you'd have to clean them pretty well. But no, I was going to say, probably not comfortable. The vulcanization of rubber in, like, the Industrial Revolution actually made condoms more affordable and more people could get them.
Like, accessible?
Yeah, this was the word I was looking for. Yep.
Also, just FYI, you can fit a condom on your arm from your fingertip to your elbow. So, like a normal size condom.
Oh, you mean when it's 9 inches?
Yes. Long. Fingertip to your elbow. Sword, if you have any thunder. Questions, you can ask Sunny, who one day during human sexuality class, when we were freshmen in college.
You know, like you do.
As you do, as one does when you are in human sexuality class when you're 90 years old. And the professor says, the male professor says, a condom, if a man ever tells you that they're too big to wear a condom, make sure that you know that a condom will fit on your arm from your fingertip to your elbow, a regular sized condom. So what did we do?
Well, tried.
Got out my messenger bag, whipped out a condom. Yes, it was in my messenger bag. And we just pulled that thing down her arm. Was it easy? No, but arms are not shaped the same way it would be easier on a man. But like, I'm just here to tell you.
It works.
That it works. And you should tell your daughters and also your sons.
Right.
Don't let them tell you.
Tell everybody up in this.
Tell everybody.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Anywho.
What are we doing next?
Oh, yeah. So what we actually should have probably talked about this at the start of the show. However, now is as good a time as any. Mm-hmm. We have decided that whistle April is that. New. We're going to whistle down that.
No, you did. You're like, anytime is as good as any. Dear reader.
This author.
Dear listener. Oh, would you like to see how much a condom goes from my finger to my elbow?
Ugh.
Capital R for rake. For rake.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Gross. So in April, we are doing newer author month.
Yeah.
So we're starting off with Becka Mack. And then on this episode will air on the 5th. And then on the 19th, we are doing S.L. Prater's next book. And that's something in heists. I forget.
God, we're the worst.
I know. We had it last time. We actually talked about it. We looked it up during the last one. Hexes and Heists, I believe. Hexes and Heists. Yeah. Okay. So we're doing that. And we will also have an interview with her. I'm writing this in our spreadsheet. Before we forget again,
it's Heist and Hexes, motherfucker. SL, you know I love you, so you know I'm just having a hard time. It's alliteration, and I'm not good at it.
It is alliteration.
I knew the two words that were in it, but God, it was hard for me to remember pride and premeditation. For God's sakes, I literally had to look at. Sense and second degree murder because I'm like I'm
yeah,
never
that's
gonna
true.
The things that go through my mind on a regular basis it's like a sieve. Anyhow. SL, I love you, don't worry.
Yeah, it's nothing personal.
No.
It's also way too late on a Friday. So anywho, that's what we're doing this month. We will have interviews with both authors, and we're super excited about it. I'm really honored that they're taking the time to talk with us about their books and about their writing process and lots of probably ridiculous things like what are you going to bring to a desert island? Potato and Harry Styles already included. Just assume they're there.
I still think back to that interview. We're like, but there was vindication because you were so vindicated afterwards.
That was with Emma Jackson, wasn't it?
It was. Yeah. Where you were like... You could charge a Kindle with it.
I'm gonna bring a potato. You guys are like, what are you talking about?
And then we found out that
I was so vindicated.
True. Yeah, I think what vindicated you? Oh, leverage vindicated you. Because on one episode, they were like, the kid was like, well, you know, you could charge something with a potato, right? It was a science fair like episode.
Holla.
Yep.
I did it. Yes.
You do. You rock.
Oh, I try so hard.
Do you know, I would travel 1,000 miles.
If I could just see you again.
So I could... Oh my God, it hurts.
It does, it hurts. If you've not listened to the last episode, please do, because at some point, Ray called me Vanessa.
And I don't know why the first name after that was Vanessa Carlton that came to my mind.
Yeah, so obviously now, Vanessa Carlton.
She had that one, still only that one song, right? Was that it?
I saw her in concert at Six Flags.
that old guy that came out the bump 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 bump? Did he open for her? Did he open for her?
No, I think it was Michelle Branch. I think Michelle Branch. I think she opened for Michelle Branch. Doesn't that track? Yeah. I think she opened for Michelle Branch. I'm crying.
Oh my god, my stomach hurts so bad right now. Because I'm sure at one point it's just there's no sound. It's just me just like wheezing like Dom DeLuise. He died too, like Chris Farley. Oh my god! Oh. Like, oh, I'm gonna die. It's fine. Again, oh, minus the hookers.
It hurts minus so much. And maybe the blow?
Oh, I mean, definitely. Definitely. Definitely rolled up $100 bills.
Oh, God. Oh, God. Okay. I'm crying.
Just see you tonight. Remember that video? She was like, they were driving her through
China. She was on a piano.
Yeah. She was in the back of a truck. Oh, my God.
Like in a desert? Oh, my God.
Oh, my God. Good times, guys. So then after that, we've got things. I don't remember what we're doing after that. It's fine. We don't
know. Well, then we don't know what we're doing on the 3rd, but May is shaping out pretty quickly where we're going to do Book Lovers by Emily Henry, which comes out on May 3rd, but we are very not likely to get an ARC.
We did.
We were denied, actually. Yeah, okay.
Denied.
So we will do Book Lovers on the 17th.
Unless Emma wants to send us her copy.
Unless somebody wants to send us a copy. And then we did today, as we mentioned earlier, got approved for the Alexis Hall book that is coming out on the 24th. So we're going to do our episode on the 31st to start Pride Month early, and we will just publish a written review online so that we're fulfilling the ask of the ARC.
Yeah.
But we will also do an episode because you know we love Alexis Hall around here.
We do. We do.
And we have another ARC coming in that'll come out July 12th because that book releases the 15th. That is Circling Back to You by Julia Tiu? I'm not sure. T-I-E-U. And then the only other thing that we know of right now is Husband Material comes out in August, and we're going to do that. And Lee will be back for that episode. Yep. But that's what we got going on.
All right, and to find us, I had it open. I do still have it open. Do you want me to read it? I can read it. I'll read it real fast. So,
sure. Where can people find us?
Oh, my God. They can find us at the chickletbookclubpodcast.com. And they can find our merch at that same podcast, but they can also go to chickletbookclubpodcast.threadless.com. Our Twitter is at chickletpodcast. Our TikTok is chickletbookclub. Our Pinterest is chickletbookclubpodcast. Our email is chickletbookclubpodcast@gmail.com. Our Instagram is chickletbookclubpodcast. Our YouTube is our fucking YouTube. Damn it.
Our That's Facebook, three,
Ray. I only wrote two. Okay. Our Patreon. We need this week, you and I offline will talk.
Yes. We need to get our
our tiers.
Patreon set up.
Yeah, we need finally. Yeah, and the tiers will go on the website. So if you are interested in keeping this
in supporting us.
Yeah, and keeping this like a ship on the water. And please,
But if you are not
financially
able or are not interested in being a Patreon supporter, we totally get that. However, if you'd like to purchase merch or if you would like to rate us and review us on the Apple Podcast app, please take a screenshot of it and email it to us at chickletbookclubpodcast@gmail.com, and we will send you a magnet.
Bitches, I got all these fucking magnets. I just want to give them out. I know. I was going, you know what? I'm going to do it. I'm going to, like, let's go out. I'm already at 25, so let's fucking do it.
Up three. I'm counting.
Listen, motherfuckers. Let's just go. You want a fucking magnet? I got you a fucking magnet.
Six.
Anthony Bridgerton's fucking butt. Let me just say how fucking
so
beautiful.
Fucking hot.
Yeah. You got one. I'd ride that cock all day long. There you go.
That's not one.
Cock is not.
Doesn't count.
Why?
Slang.
Oh, for fuck's sake. Okay, there we go.
I'm sorry, I just clapped like into the microphone.
And I'm over here like banging on the like I'm like a Tory judge, like bah, 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 bah. I'm trying to think of one more fucking thing I can say.
I think
10. We're at 10. So I'm at 35, guys. So if you'd like to match us.
23.
If you'd like to match us, we'll figure out what clown college we're gonna give these money to. No, we'll give it to something for kids.
Probably like Boys and Girls Club or something. Yeah, like that's a yeah.
Yeah.
That sounds good. Yeah. All right. We will keep everyone posted. Oh my god. Okay.
I know of somebody's defense fund we might give it to.
Oh, okay.
Or I'm sorry, prosecution fund we might give it to. So a little breaky for me. Yeah, I shouldn't say defense. Prosecution. Fund.
Prosecution. Anywho, so anyway, thank you so much for joining us on this journey. Again, thank you to everyone who's been listening to the Bridgerton episodes. It's just like I cannot even express to you how grateful we are for the support in the past couple weeks, in particular. Welcome to everybody who is new here. We hope you stick around. Feel free to send us your constructive criticism.
Yeah, I mean,
or your feelings.
Yeah, I mean, we've been good at trying to get back to everybody who writes us. So if you just have ideas, you have like compliments are always great. I mean, who fucking
always nice.
Damn it, fucking doesn't love a compliment. You might as well just go to 40. So if you don't, you know, if you want to write us, we'll fucking get you back. But just like, you know, just send us an email, chicklitbookclubpodcast@gmail.com. And, you know, but again, creative criticism. If there's something you
book
want.
Book suggestions.
Book suggestions. If there's something you're like, hey, have you heard about this? It's fucking great. Then
you author know, suggestions.
Yeah, author suggestions.
We haven't touched on an author yet.
I mean, I don't know if any of the authors want us to touch them.
Well, no. Not physically.
No. If there's anyone you want to finger.
Oh, wow.
No, that's a term. That's a term. Like, you've heard that term. About fingering, like, pointing the finger, fingering somebody for something.
Oh, okay. That's well, this is a romance novel podcast, and well, so therefore that's not where my brain went.
No, it's just fingering your butthole. I mean...
Oh my god, this is devolving very, very quickly.
I'm trying to think of something else to throw.
The train is off the tracks.
It's derailed. It's fucking derailed.
The train is complete. There it is. 40, nailed
bitches.
It.
All right. Damn it, 41.
It's 42. Motherfucker. Oh, there we go. And I'm just gonna make mine an even fucking 25. Okay. I'm sure we missed some. All right. Anyway, thank you all for joining us. Yeah. And we will see y'all very soon.
I like that. How do we end this thing?
In the most obnoxious way possible.
Oh!
Bye.
Bye.